were a knowledge-based subject in a knowledge-based career, then there would be no fun because we'd have nothing left to discover. We know everything already. There's no need for scientists. So science is actually more of ignorance than knowledge. It's because we have things that we have not discovered yet that makes our job so interesting. So schools, I assume, would want you to commit lots of facts to memory because then you absorb the textbook, you swallow the whole textbook, and now you know everything in the textbook, and that permits you guys to then start asking, what else? What else is there out there that we don't know a lot about yet? And what can I study? So a lot of scientists, as you see here, are more interested in the journey than the destination. So our job relies a lot on asking questions that you're interested in and then trying to find the answer. So it's a lot about asking the question and then challenging yourself to find the answer. And there are many ways sometimes to get to the correct answer, which is why creativity and imagination is sometimes very important for a scientist. Again, you know, you might hear in school that there might be a stereotype that scientists are very logical and methodical people, and they're very sort of, you know, always in your room, always looking down at books. But that is not true. I know scientists that are athletes. I know scientists that are skateboarders. I know scientists that, you know, I know one that plays ultimate frisbee for the UK. I myself, I go to MCM Comic Con twice a year, like a true nerd. But yeah, there are many different types of people. And the only thing that all these people have in common is that they love to solve challenging questions. And they dare to think about not just what we know that we don't know, but what we don't know that we don't know. So if you look at revolutionary scientists like Charles Darwin or Albert Einstein, they were the kind of people that asked questions that we didn't even know was a problem. You know, Charles Darwin asked about evolution, and up till then, we didn't even know that evolution was something that we needed to be talking about. And to this day, people are still talking about it. So it's a little bit of a tidbit about a career in science. If anybody's considering a career in science, it's not about knowledge, it's about ignorance. It's about knowing that you don't know and liking the fact that you don't know, because there are puzzles to solve and there's work to do. So today I want to talk to you about my work on zebrafish, and a lot of you in this room may not be biologists, some of you may be aspiring medics or maybe aspiring engineers or physicists or chemists. So I hope that you don't get too bogged down in the terminology and in the life cycle of the pathogen that I will talk about, but more in the development of the idea. So how we take scientific questions, do the experiments, get the results, and then analyze those results and what kind of next steps we take from that. So what are the important next steps to take from the results that you get in the lab? And that process, I think, is a lot more integral to scientists and a lot more applicable no matter what field of science you go into. So without further ado, let's start on that. So chytridiomycosis. Chytridiomycosis is a fungal pathogen, a fungal disease that infects 500 amphibians. It is one of the biggest causes of amphibian extinction worldwide, and it has already taken a couple of species off the face of our Earth. It can wipe out up to 80% of frogs in a naive population. You can see here, these pictures were taken by Matt Fisher in Madagascar, and all these frogs are dead. As you can see, they sort of die upside down, you know, kind of paralyzed like this. And recently, there has been a lot of focus on trying to figure out how this pathogen infects frogs, because it's quite a mystery. It infects frogs, it causes these little lumps on the frog's skin, which is a result of hyperkeratosis. So we think that the fungus gets in, it builds up layers and layers of skin on top of the frog's existing skin, and it forms a scab of keratin. The fungus is a saprophore, it likes to feed on keratin. Keratin helps it grow, which is why we think it does this. And the frogs eventually die of cardiac arrest because these scabs block the respiratory apparatus of the frog. It's a slow and painful death to this animal. And we really don't know a lot about it. It's very difficult to study host response in a frog because frogs, first of all, are very big and they're opaque, so they're not very good for microscopy. It takes 3 months to infect the frog. So you spend 3 months trying to make this animal sick, and then you kill it, and there's not a lot of information you can get out of it. So it's not a very efficient system. So there's more and more work towards wanting to know what parts of the immune system are important for this infection, and how is this fungus killing so many frogs. Because the important thing to note is that it infects 700 amphibians, but they are amphibians which carry the fungus, which are not infected at all. So they carry it asymptomatically, and this becomes problematic when people are shipping frogs worldwide for the pet trade or for food, because then you're introducing this fungus into new populations where it could potentially take out lots and lots of species there. So a little bit about the background on chytridiomycosis. Chytridiomycosis is caused by a fungal pathogen called Bactetrachytrium dendrobatidis, which I will refer to as BD. So it has an aquatic life cycle, which is slightly weird for a fungus. It starts off as a tiny zoospore. So this zoospore is about 2 microns with a 20 micron flagellum tail, and it swims around in whatever liquid. And when it finds a spot that's rich in keratin, it will incise down and it will protrude these little pseudohyphae into the first 2 layers of cells. Then this chytrid thallus that's on the top here will expand and form many tiny zoospores inside. So this mature sporangium here is a bit like a mushroom. It has lots of tiny little spores inside this big balloon, which eventually bursts and releases new zoospores into the surrounding environment. So here we have examples of these different life stages on frog skin. So this is a histology section. So what you do is after the frog has been infected, we euthanize it and then we fix it in paraformaldehyde, and then we cut paper thin sections. So this is a section down of frog skin, and we can see the different stages of infection. So you can see here there's a little pseudohyphae coming out of a little chytrid thallus, and then here we see a huge mature sporangium characterized by these little multinucleate spots. So this corresponds to that life stage. And number 4, this empty space here corresponds to a discharged sporangium, which is that one there. So, as I said, this infection takes a long time to develop in amphibians and an even longer time to kill. So we need a faster way to study host pathogen interactions if we want to figure out why so many of these frogs are dying from this terrible disease. So my organism of choice is zebrafish, and it is admittedly a very weird idea. Why would you want to translate a frog infection into a fish? And the truth is that this idea came from 2 supervisors who were in a pub, and they came up with this crazy idea. One worked on fish and one worked on the fungus, and they thought that what if we put the two together? But they didn't have the funding to work on it, so that's where I came in. Zebrafish have many great qualities. We work on the larvae, so they're about 2 cm across and they're completely translucent, which makes them very great for microscopy because you can see all the way through them. So you can label them with various antibodies and dyes, and you can see different types of cells or different types of proteins and where they localize. There's also many different assays available for zebrafish, and interestingly enough, zebrafish are aquatic. So it could possibly be a vector that is spreading BD to different species of amphibians. So if fish are carrying BD, that means that when fish start to swim into different territories, or when people, you know, dump huge amounts of trout to refill rivers and things like that, you could potentially be introducing a very dangerous fungal pathogen into that area. A little bit on the life cycle of the zebrafish. So at 0 days, they are eggs. You get about 50 eggs per adult, and by day 3, they hatch. And that larvae is the 2 centimeter larvae I'm talking about, and that is where we start our infection. So we put this little larvae into 1 ml of water, and then we just inoculate it with zoospores, and let the zoospores swim around in the water and potentially attach to fish. So other studies have shown that BD can infect other orders of animals other than frogs. So they can infect crayfish. This is a nematode worm, and these are water birds. So apparently they parasitize the keratin-rich toenails of these water birds here. But in all 3 of these models, it's shown that BD can be carried on these amphibians, but it doesn't show that it does anything else. It just sticks on them, and then we don't really know what it's doing. So we wanted to take our model further than what has been done before, and ask, can zebrafish be infected by BD? So we need a black and white way of showing that yes, they are infected. And wonderfully, we thought they are, because we put infected zebrafish down a microscope, and as you can see here, a control fish, it has very neat muscle striations, it has this caudal fin that goes all around the larvae, and that looks nice and healthy. But in infected fish, and you can see in a large section here, the muscle striations have sort of sunken into the fish, and they look very unhealthy. And you see these little blistering structures on its skin. And these blistering structures look very similar to the phenotypes that we would see in frogs. So frogs form these blisters on their skin when they're infected, and we think that these two things could potentially be the same thing. We think that these blisters are a genuine phenotype of BD infection. But of course, there needs to be proof of that. This is a speculation, so this is the idea, and we now need to go on and test that. So we first proved that zebrafish can indeed be infected by BD. So on top here, you see a histopathological section of frog skin. And again, I remind you that these are little structures of BD. So these are sporangia here, and that's a discharge sporangia there. And we can see that in fish skin. So this is the same protocol performed in fish. And we can see these little chytrid phalluses that have insisted onto zebrafish skin. And then another one there, and we believe that this is a discharge sporangium. So it's already released its zoospores into the water. And this is the shell of what once was. So this evidence strongly suggests that fish are not just infected by BD, but they're infected in the same way. So they're undergoing the same infection process as amphibians, which is really interesting, because it means that our results are translatable between the two systems. So when we prove that zebrafish can be infected, we need to quantify that infection. We need a way to say that, yes, this fish is infected, no, that fish is not infected, so that we have a system, we have a dose-dependent response. So we have two ways of doing that. The first way is to just look at them visually, so by caudal fin area. So as you can see in control fish, it is time post-infection, hours post-infection, so 24, 48, and 72 hours. In a control fish, the fin stays relatively neat and tidy and intact throughout the whole process. But in an infected fish, you see that in a low-dose infected fish, the caudal fin is somewhat eroded by 72 hours. But in a high-dose infected fish, the caudal fin is completely eroded by 72 hours. So that's all well and good. We can say that that is a phenotype of BD infection, but we need to quantify that. And I think I have measured about 200 fish individually on a computer, just measuring this length of fin up here. So we take this length of fin here, and this length of fin here, and then average all three, and I did this individually for 200 fish, to produce these three graphs. So at 24 hours, all the fin lengths look very similar to control, and this starts to decrease, particularly in high-dose fish, as we go on. So 48 hours is a little bit lower, and 72 hours is all very low. So it's correlating very well, and we say that this phenotype of fin erosion is a genuine phenotype of BD infection. So it's a way to tell that fish are infected and how infected they are. The second phenotype, we use coprophore white, which is a fluorescent dye. So it labels chitin. Sporangia of BD have a cell wall that's made of chitin. So we stain that chitin with coprophore white, and we hope to be able to observe localization of BD on our infected fish. So as you can see here, I don't know if it's really big enough, but by 72 hours, we see these green punctae all over our fish, which shows that they've been infected by BD, because the green is staining chitin, which is only present on BD sporangia and not present normally through the fish. And you can see in our control samples here that are not showing any green at all. And again, this phenotype appears between 48 and 72 hours. So that is in correlation with our fin erosion here, that you see severe fin erosion happens between 48 and 72 hours, and coprophore labeled punctae happens between 48 and 72 hours. And again, we quantify this, and I haven't shown stats here for simplicity's sake, but the low and high, the high dose fish is have significantly more fluorescent punctae on them than control fish. So this is another way that we quantify how infected fish are. So now that we have a model, we have a way to infect fish, we can prove they're infected, we can prove that, you know, there's a that they show a dose-dependent response. The more BD you hit them with, the more infected they get. So seems to work out. So what are the consequences of BD infection on host tissue? Now we get to the exciting part. What can we do with zebrafish that we can't do in frogs? So what new things can we discover about BD, or what new techniques can we use that previously couldn't have been used in frogs? So here we are showing that there are a few key phenotypes of BD infection that are replicated in the fish. So showing you that fish and amphibians undergo the same sort of infection stages, and they're infected in the same way. So this is fluorescent labeling of apoptotic cells, so they're dying cells, and we've labeled them in red. This is by a technique called tunnel staining. And we can see in infected fish, the white dotted outline shows the outline of the fish. The red dots here are dying cells. And there are many more dying cells in infected fish than controls. Each one of these dots on the graph show an individual fish, which I've counted the dots on, and we can see that infected fish has way more dots, way more dying cells. We also did some electron microscopy with Mike Hollinshed here in Cambridge, and we see that in control cells, the edges of the cells are very nice and they adhere together on the skin, whereas in infected cells, cells start to slough off, so you can see that this cell is now no longer attached to its basement membrane. This is actually one of the key ways in which BD gets transmitted through different amphibians, because these infected skin cells from frog will slough off, get into the water, and then infect everything else around it. And the third phenotype, this is histopathology, which I've shown you before, but now I've just made this clear by drawing this white line, that in control fish, you see a very thin layer of skin on top of muscle, so these are muscle striations here. But in infected fish, we see this uncontrolled proliferation of skin cells. You can see that they are not in beautiful layers at all. They are just sort of growing around everywhere, and you have this little sporangia here, here, and here, sort of stuck, nestled inside its castle made of keratin, forming a blister on the fish. So these three things, you know, prove to us that yes, we can be very sure that fish are undergoing the same sort of infection process. And these are just a snapshot of the different kinds of things that we can do to study this infection. So my favorite phenotype in my research is this, what I call actin disorganization. So here we are labeling actin, and this is a fluorescent image of the muscle of zebrafish. So as you can see, when there is no disorganization, all of the actin striations are nice and neat and closely packed together, and this gets worse and worse as we go down to severe disorganization. And we call this the braided rope phenotype because it looks a little bit like a braided rope. So this is a close-up section of this section of the fish here. And again, like all good scientists, we quantify things, we put things into numbers, and we show that infected fish have a lot more severe muscle disorganized fish as compared to our controls, which don't have any, and they have some which show some mild muscle disorganization, but not a lot. So the way that we categorize none, mild, and severe, we actually have a rubric for this, which I'm not showing you, which I have not shown in this slide, but we have a rubric which we score how severe muscle disorganization is from 1, 2, 3 to 4, 4 being the most severe. So I will score all the fish, and then I'll get someone else in the lab to score the fish independently from me, and then we average those two values. So that gives us a reliable measure of how bad muscle disorganization is, because this can be a little bit, it could be a little bit subjective, so we're trying to reduce that subjectivity in our science. And by far one of the most amazing things that we can do is someone came up with a BD antibody. So MAB just stands for monoclonal antibody, and 5C4 is a receptor on both life cycle stages of BD. So both zoospores and sporangia have this receptor on their surface, and we can now label that in green because it's the best color. And we can see that these blisters I mentioned before that I thought were a phenotype of BD infection, and we can see that they are genuinely a phenotype of BD infection because the green from the BD antibody is co-localizing to the blisters. So that's a bright field image, that's DNA, that's the antibody, and then we merge them all together and you see co-localization and a little spot of DNA on the inside of the blister, which is quite cool. And 2 years of work accumulated to doing something like this. So in frogs, you can see this, right? You can see different stages of BD infection on frog skin. So this is an insistent zoospore. It goes into a thallus, and that goes into a mature sporangium, these multinucleate structures here. It takes 3 months to get this set of pictures. 3 months and a lot of fiddly work. We can do this in fish in a week. And we can see it at an amazing resolution. So we see here there's a zoospore with its little pseudohypha going into the cell. This is what we believe to be a Petri thallus sitting on top of a group of cells. And what is most amazing to me is that we can see a Petri thallus here with cells that are potentially coming up around it. So it's starting to form its castle of keratin and bury itself inside that keratin layer. And this is absolutely incredible, because here we've only stained for BD, but I could very easily stain for both BD and macrophages. And then I could possibly see, maybe I would see more macrophages around the infection site than I would see everywhere else around the fish. So I could see how the immune system responds to this BD infection. I could construct movies, like I showed you at the beginning of this slideshow, with this antibody in play. This is just a snapshot of what we could potentially do with the zebrafish model. And here I've shown a schematic diagram of how I think this process is happening. So these are all done on fish that are infected at 72 hours post-infection. So we can see all three stages of infection at 72 hours after infection. So it takes 3 days. We can see infection in 3 days. We have potentially sped up our study of this pathogen by about 2 months, and we can now use these high-end confocal microscopy techniques, do all this differential labeling, because in these black and white diagrams, it is very difficult to tell what is what. So, you know, there are people who do a lot of histopathology and they can tell that what type of skin cells or what and so on, but this is so much easier. Everything blue is DNA, everything green is BD, and then I can do everything red is something else, everything pink is something else, and co-localize all that, and you can see where everything is and how everything is interacting. So as a quick conclusion for you, we have developed a BD zebrafish infection model to study host pathogen interactions of BD. So we've developed a model, meaning we've developed a protocol that you can infect fish, prove they're infected. We can show that they show similar phenotypes to amphibians and genuine phenotypes of infection themselves. And we hope that this model will be added to the limited toolkit to study the infection of BD. As you can see as well, coming back to the ecological point, the fact that BD can proliferate on zebrafish means that fish could potentially act as an unexamined reservoir of chytrid infection. And that comes back to, unexamined reservoirs of parasitic chytrids. Yes, so when people are dumping trout in lakes or when fish are swimming or migrating, they could potentially be carrying parasitic chytrids with them and introducing them to new populations. Obviously, our infection is on a zebrafish larvae, so it's a 2-3-day-old larvae. It may not translate into older fish, but that is an experiment that we would like to try in the future. We would also like to try co-housing zebrafish larvae with frogs and seeing if zebrafish could potentially pass their infection to frogs. But we think it can, because we've seen evidence that BD doesn't just carry and sit on zebrafish like it does with water birds and like it does with nematodes, but it actually insists, proliferates, and releases more zoospores into the surrounding atmosphere. So that proves a very interesting point of study for further research. So now we go on to the third bit of the talk, which is a bit on my experience as a scientist. So I'm Malaysian by passport, by origin, that's my home. I came to the UK at the age of 16 alone, and I wanted to pursue a career in science here because you guys have such amazing resources for science. And back home, back where I came from, nobody wanted to do science. If you were good at science, you might as well become a medic. That, like, who would do a career in pure science? But I wanted to do it because, yeah. And now I'm 21, okay? So in that 5 years of time, I started the research on zebrafish in Imperial College in about 2015, and I continued this work through my undergrad. I would have lectures all the way from Monday to Saturday, finish my lectures, take the train down to Imperial, do experiments, freeload on a PhD student's couch for a night, and then go back tomorrow and write my essays and submit those essays on Monday. It was a turbulent time. I received a little bit of money for what I did. I received a Lister studentship a year later, and the manuscript was published in April of 2017. And, you know, like many scientists, I'm more interested in the journey than the destination. So once the manuscript was published, I sort of went, well, what other questions could I ask? What other things could I do? What other things could I find out? So I started an internship at UCL, doing a different project on more classic biochemistry, working on phosphorylation and signaling pathways. So you're welcome to ask me about that later if you touch me. But this whole experience has been incredibly amazing, and I have met so many inspiring people that only reinforced my want to do cell biology. But nothing in life is easy. For every green bubble on that slide, there are more, I think there's like three red bubbles for every green bubble. And this is not supposed to be down, it's supposed to sort of tell you guys that nothing is easy, whether you go out and you work for a bank, or you want to work in a lab, or you want to be a doctor. You're going to come into lots of trials and tribulations and troubles, but it doesn't have to be easy. It just has to be worth it. And I hope that, you know, if you guys want to pursue a career in science, one day you will be sitting at a microscope at 9 o'clock at night on a Sunday in a cold, dark room all by yourself, and you'll put in a sample that you spent a week trying to get, and you'll turn on your laser, turn on your computer, and you'll see something that nobody else in the world has seen before. And you will be the first person to ever know something that has not been written in textbooks, something that is completely new to us, and it's a completely new truth. And it will be your responsibility to take that truth and interpret it, and do whatever you want with it, and translate it to the world as a scientist. And I guarantee you, if you go on a scientific career, you will have at least one of those moments in your life. And it will be, and it will all be worth it. And I leave you with this comic, my favorite comic, by Grant Snyder on Instagram for Comics. And I think it summarizes my drive to be a scientist very well. Thank you very much.
Pleasure. Does anyone have any questions?
So when you came to England when you were 16, what did you plan on doing? Did you always want to go into science right from the start?
Yes, I did. I did want to go into science. I did receive some pressure from my family to go into medicine. And I actually initially applied for medicine when I did my A-levels, in which I got rejected from all of the medical schools because the medical interviewer said that I loved science too much to be a medic. And that was the calling to go and get some lab experience, which is actually how I ended up in Imperial College during my gap year. So that was a very good experience for me to solidify that I wanted to go into science. Yeah?
You found so much during your research and your undergraduate degree, how did you manage to do
that? Through the sheer force of will. No. I really enjoy doing science, and so I really wanted to commit because at that point I had already been working on zebrafish for a year and it was very much my baby. So I really, really wanted to finish it up and do it well. I think that one of the things that people get misconstrued is that to be a scientist you need to be very, very book smart and you need to spend a lot of time on your studies. But actually when you get to university I find a lot of supervisors, they rather take students with slightly lower grades because they tend to be better in the lab. They tend to be more imaginative and creative and focus less on like the nitty-gritty facts and more on the big picture, what could we be doing right now. So that's, yeah. Yeah, the both of them.
How did you get interested in cell biology?
In cell biology in particular, I got interested in it when I learned about it in A-level, and I learned that there are 10 proteins that are conserved all the way from the simplest bacteria to us. So that puts our existence in perspective, I think, is that, you know, we are just bags of cells and bags of cells sort of bounded together, and we are all sort of connected all the way back to bacteria. I find that cells are a fundamental unit of life, and it is amazing that we can see things so small and see them move and change. And, you know, whenever I look at them, I always think nature is a lot smarter than we think. It's a lot more complex than it looks, and yeah, that's why I like it.
Okay. You said that there are always moments that you look forward to and then you realize it's all worth it.
Yeah.
Do you have a moment like that?
I do have a moment like that. It was actually the first time that I spoke in front of a crowd when I did a seminar once in Imperial College on this work. It was the first time I'd ever talked about the work. I was about 19 then, and there were, you know, professors and PhD students who showed up to hear me talk. And after the talk, someone did ask a question similar to that, and they asked me if I'd ever been in an environment where have I ever been in a lab environment, and what was that like? And I said that during my A-levels, I was the only kid who wanted to do science in my school, who wanted to do a career in science. But now I am surrounded by lots of people who all want to do science, and I've never been in an environment like that before, and it's really great. And someone from the back shouted, "Welcome home," and I started to cry, and that's when I knew that I really, really wanted to do science. And it is really wonderful not just to do science, but to be amongst other people who love to do science, which is what you would get if you want to go into a scientific career.
We'll get to a quick question.
Yeah.
So I'm John McMaster from University of Nottingham. Thanks for a fantastic talk. Really enjoyed it. Getting on to the science of it.
Yeah.
What else are these zebrafish larvae used for? So specifically for this kind of pathogen, or what else can we use these things?
So the zebrafish are primarily used for sort of immunology. So they're used to create models against certain infections that we have. So there's a model for zebrafish against aspergillus, there's one against shigella, which causes dysentery.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a way to sort of, it's a way to look at a pathogen in a different system, in a system that is easy to study. But zebrafish larvae are also very well used in development.
Mm-hmm.
So because they have a completely transparent development from an egg to the formation of somites into the larvae, so you can see how each bit develops, and they're so easy to label that you can see where every single cell is going. So they're used primarily in those two fields. But we hope that they will be more popular as a model organism in the future.
And how close are you finding the cure for these four frogs?
We are not that close, to be honest. There's still a lot of work to be done. We hope that our findings will just increase the amount of work, increase the kind of work that we can do on these pathogens and trying to slowly find an answer. The muscle degeneration phenotype that I showed you before, we actually link that phenotype back to something frogs have, which they lose their writing reflex when they're infected. So they can no longer swim and their muscles become sort of flaccid. So we are trying now to link that muscle degeneration back to a frog phenotype, and that could possibly be a reason. So yes, the honest answer is no. There's still a lot of work to be done.
Very
it's
good.
Just the beginning. Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
How do you minimize the amount of pain inflicted on the zebrafish when you're infecting them with BD?
So zebrafish at 3 days post-fertilization, they have a fully developed innate immune system, but they have not yet fully developed their neural system. So we sort of think that means that they don't fully feel pain. And also we keep our infections to 3 days. So we don't infect them for any longer than 3 days to minimize harm to them. And we always euthanize our zebrafish with it is a certain type of chemical that causes muscle paralysis, so they die in the most painless way cycle. So what happens is they just sort of go to sleep and die there. So that we try to take as much caution as we can to have as little pain on the fish as possible. And obviously we do not use fish unless we really have to. Like, we don't perform experiments on fish unless we really have to.
What inspired you to do science to begin with? Like, what made you want to continue to study? Where did you get all your passion?
I guess when I came to England, I had an interest in science, but I didn't know where that interest could go. Like, I was interested in science, but at that point I felt that I could really do anything in science. I don't really mind. I just like it. But the more I worked on it, the more I felt like, yeah, this is what I want to do. It was sort of like the more I knew about the subject, the more I felt that, oh man, there's so many things that we could be asking. There's so many things that I could think about or work on. And obviously meeting people as well. Like, I've met scientists, other teachers and other peers, which I've looked at them and been like, yeah, I want to be you. Like, in 30 years' time, I want to be sitting in your shoes. And that's how I came to that. So it's sort of, you start off with a mild interest in something and you cultivate that interest. So as you gain experience and as you go out into a work experience and so on, and ask yourself, like, do I want to do this for the rest of my life? And hopefully the answer will be yes. Yeah.
So I'm sure Nicole will take more questions if you have any more questions later on during the day. Thank you very much, and let's give a round of applause.
Much. Good. Okay, got my card. No. Well, it doesn't seem to be working. So let me just try that. I assure you it was working not 5 minutes ago. So maybe one of the technicians can give me a hand here. No. You're leaving me hanging here.
Where's OBS sticking it from?
Cool. Basically, if the audio is working, you should be able to hear it on here.
Yeah.
Where's
your sources? Have you changed it? Have you added the audio to your sources?
Is the audio not working? Everywhere. I just transitioned it back.
A round of applause for our panel. Very good.
So, can you make sure that really quick?
Okay. I'm back on track here. So, as was mentioned before, my name is Michael Sutherland. I'm a physicist from the Cavendish Laboratory and also a fellow at Corpus Christi College, one of the colleges here at the University of Cambridge. So, what I'm going to talk about is essentially most of undergraduate quantum physics, a little bit of graduate quantum physics, and the latest updates on research in superconductivity And we've got about half an hour to do it, so I might go a little bit quick. But I have to warn you, there's a slight health warning, this presentation contains a bit of math. So just so that you know, but since you're here as young scientists, hopefully you won't be too afraid of the equations. I'll talk you through them and lead you through the mathematics as gently as I can. So let's begin just by thinking a little bit about what quantum physics is. People hear the term quantum, but I think there's a lot of misconceptions about what quantum really means. And I like to think of quantum physics as really being the rules of how nature works at the microscopic scale. So quantum physics tells us about how atoms and electrons and protons and neutrons behave. And what you find out if you study quantum and as has been demonstrated repeatedly by many experiments, is that nature behaves very strangely on small scale, very counterintuitively, very differently than what we're used to when we consider the physics of everyday objects. So just as an example, if I think of this footballer trying to kick the football into the net, if I know the force that is put on this ball, and I know various things such as the air resistance and spin on the ball, I can predict, if I know all these variables, I can predict with 100% certainty whether this football will go into the net by using Newton's law, F equals ma. And that's something that we're all used to. We've been doing these questions perhaps as part of your schoolwork, and we're all comfortable with this idea that if we know all the inputs into a problem, we know what's going to happen. But the quantum world is very different. The quantum world actually doesn't deal in certainties like Newton's law does. Even if we know everything there is to know about an electron or a proton, the best we can do is predict with some probability what the outcome of a certain experiment will be. So we can never know for sure what the outcome of an experiment will be. If you had a quantum football and you knew everything about it, we wouldn't know for sure whether it would go in the net or not. Best we can do is deal in probabilities, and that's very, very different. The other very interesting thing about the quantum theory is that it demonstrates that on the small scale, particles behave like waves, and waves can behave like particles. So again, that's very different than what we're used to experiencing at sort of the macroscopic scale. So in the next few minutes of the talk, we're going to talk about this sort of picture of an electron and what it's like. You may have seen this cartoon picture, sort of electrons whizzing around a nucleus, and that's a nice sort of way to think about things, but it's not actually in reality what an electron is. So hopefully we'll demonstrate in the next few minutes how a real quantum physicist thinks about something like an electron, a microscopic particle. Probably one of the most remarkable experiments in physics, in my opinion, is this one. And some of you may have heard about this experiment. This was one of the first experiments that really demonstrated something strange is happening on the microscopic scale. And this is a famous double slit experiment. So in the early part of the 20th century, when people were wrestling with this idea of whether, let's say, electrons were waves or particles, there was a wonderful proposal for an experiment that went something like this. Imagine you had a source of electrons, and you could produce these electrons one at a time, and you allow them to impinge upon a screen that had two slits in it. Well, clearly these electrons were waves. As they went through those slits, what you would find is that they would interfere with each other constructively and deconstructively, so peaks and troughs would add or subtract, and you get these sort of bands of more intense areas and less intense areas. And that's what you would expect if an electron were a wave. If an electron were a particle, you can imagine the source would be something like this, almost like a machine gun firing out these electrons. And when they went through these slits, you would just see these bands here, these little dots, these points of electrons as they hit the detector. So here's an actual video of this experiment, and this is being done on electrons. And so you can see what happens. The first few electrons are going through, there's some dots here, and you think, well, clearly this is just demonstrating electrons or particles, because we're seeing this little spot here appear on the screen. But something interesting happens if you count a whole bunch of these electrons. If you let this run for a little bit of time, and we're speeding up time a little bit, we're seeing many, many of these electrons coming through. And what you'll start to see is there's a pattern forming. the pattern forming and the distribution of where these electrons are landing. And it's starting to form now, and you can actually see it here and here. It's much more likely, and here, it's much more likely that electrons are landing, and there's fewer electrons landing here. So the interpretation of this is really a nice example of showing electron in some situations can behave like a particle, and in some situations can behave like a wave. And the really interesting thing to note is the way that this experiment is done, only one electron is going through the slits at a time. So it's not like many electrons are interfering with each other, bumping into each other. One electron is going through the slit at a time. And the interpretation of this is as the electron is traveling through the slit, it's actually traveling through both slits at the same time, behaving like a wave, interfering with itself. And then when it hits the screen, it's localized. It appears as a particle. And that is a very profound and very, very different type of behavior than what you would expect if you threw, say, tennis balls or something in the macroscopic world through those slits. So waves can behave as particles, and particles can behave as waves. Now, the first person who really came up with a mathematical expression which relates this wave behavior with particles is this man. His name is Louis de Broglie, and he proposed that every particle has an associated wavelength, which we call lambda here, and the size of this wavelength is given by this simple formula here. So this is h, a constant called Planck's constant. This is the mass of the particle and the velocity of the particle is traveling. And what you can see here, first of all, is that this constant, Planck's constant, is very, very small, 6.6 times 10 to the minus 34. That's tiny. And that explains why we don't see quantum behavior in everyday life. It's only at the microscopic scales that we see it. So given this experiment, given this idea, it's clear that if we want to understand matter from the microscopic point of view, we need to formulate a theory of matter that's based on waves. So let's think a little bit about waves and how we might describe them. So if you've ever spent some time staring at ripples on a pond, you may have thought a little bit about what sort of characteristics you can ascribe to a wave. And you might give it an amplitude, so how far away the wave is from the equilibrium position. You might assign a wave a wavelength, so the distance between the various peaks or troughs. And you might assign a wave a frequency, so how fast, how often these wave fronts are coming. And those are kind of the main characteristics that you would use to mathematically describe a wave. So if we put all this together into a mathematical picture, physicists and mathematicians will often try and describe a wave in terms of a function that is called a wave function. So we call it usually psi in physics, that little pitchfork-shaped Greek letter. And this wave function will be a function of position and of time. So this is, of course, a one-dimensional case looking at, say, a wave traveling along a string. And what this allows us to do is we can go to a particular position and a particular time, and we can see how far away the piece of the string here is from equilibrium. So it tells us everything we need to know about how a wave is propagating, the amplitude of the wave, the frequency of the wave. So this wave function can be very different for different kinds of waves, but mathematically it tells us everything we need to know about a wave. So how does this apply to quantum physics? In quantum physics, we assign every particle, proton, neutron, electron, a wave function, one of these mathematical expressions that's based on a wave propagating. And this wave function has a very special property in quantum physics. So unlike, say, the example of a string where the wave function told us how far away a piece of the string was from its equilibrium position, in quantum physics, the square of the wave function tells us the probability of finding a particle at that position and that particular time. So let's just imagine we had a wave function that when we squared it looked like this. This would tell us if we were to do 1,000 or 1,000,000 experiments on this particular particle with this particular wave function, we would most likely find it here. Sometimes we would find the particle here, and sometimes over here. Sometimes it could be, you know, way back in Canada where I'm from, but the probability would be very, very small of that occurring. But the idea I want you to get from this is that we can assign a wave function to each particle, and the square of this wave function, the amplitude, tells us about the probability of finding a particle. So that's how we bring mathematics of waves into quantum physics. So once we have this this sort of formulated, we need to have now some kind of equation that allows us to deal with all of these particles in the same way that Newton's laws allow us to deal with footballs and airplanes and planets. And the person who proposed this equation is this sort of thoughtful-looking guy here. This is Erwin Schrödinger. He came up with some somewhat cruel thought experiments involving cats, which we'll save for another day. But his sort of main contribution to physics is this equation here. And this is known as Schrödinger's equation. And this is, I mean, somebody might correct me on this, but I think this is the most important equation in all of physics. And more time, money, tears, blood, sweat have gone into solving this equation, I think, than any other equation in all of physics. So it is a very important equation. And let's just have a look at this. So this equation has this pitchfork wave function, this psi here. You can see it's got Planck's constant there, that h that I mentioned. It's got the mass of a particle, and there's the wave function I mentioned. It has the potential energy of a particle, so this could be, say, the Coulomb repulsion of like charges. It could be even gravitational potential. And then it has the total energy of the particle. So essentially, this governs the behavior of electrons or protons and neutrons at this small microscopic scale. So it's like the Newton's law for the quantum world. And we can just try to solve it in a simple sort of limit. Let's imagine the following situation. This is what you'll do in first year physics if you go and study it at university. We can imagine a particular form of this potential. Imagine we have a particle here. It's got mass and velocity. It's behaving like a wave, of course. And it's bouncing around inside this box. And this box has a length L. And at the side of this box, the potential energy goes to infinity, and inside the box, the potential energy is zero. So that's the situation that we have our wave slash particle in. If we were to analyze this by trying to solve Schrödinger's equation in this way, we would find a number of solutions. Actually, there's lots of solutions, and they all have wave functions which look like this. They have a sign there, they have x, which is the position, and L, which is the distance here. So these are the solutions of Schrödinger's equation in this very simple one-dimensional box. And one thing you might notice, actually, is that each one of these solutions here is labeled by an energy. So that's the energy that comes out here, E1, E2, E3. And these are discrete values of energy. So the system cannot have an energy that's E1 plus a little bit or E2 minus a bit. It must have these discrete energies. So that's the origin of the word quanta, or quantized. In this situation, given the constraints that this potential puts on the particle, it must have these quantized values of energy. And I can show you what these wave functions look like. On the left here, these are the wave functions themselves. On the right here, these are the wave functions squared. Remember I said this was proportional to the probability of finding the particle. So we put the particle inside this box, and we do a measurement, and it's in the lowest energy state. We'd probably find it in the middle of the box. We'd never find it at the edges. But if it's in a slightly higher energy state, we'd never find it in the middle, but we'd find it most likely in these two places. So that's very different than what you'd expect from a classical particle. That just gives you a flavor of what it's like to solve the Schrödinger's equation. Now, let's return back to the picture of an atom. So we have this cartoon picture in our head that we all learned perhaps in school, of these electrons whizzing around this nucleus. These are negatively charged, these are positively charged. This, as I mentioned, is wrong. It's a nice cartoon picture, but it's not really reality. To solve for the behavior of a wave-like electron in this picture, we need to solve Schrödinger's equation. Just like we did in one dimension here, we can generalize this to three dimensions. So now we let the particle roam all around in space. It can go this way, that way, all around this central nucleus. The equation gets a bit more complicated. I'm not going to ask you to solve this, but if you go on to do physics, you'll spend most of your second year quantum physics course solving this particular problem. And the solutions that you get out of it look like this. So these are the square of the wave function solutions for the situation where you have an electron that's negatively charged whizzing around a positively charged nucleus. And of course, these wave functions would actually be in three dimensions, but I've just taken a cut here along the plane. And you can see that there are each one of these, this is the lowest energy state, this is a higher energy state, this is an even higher energy state. And in this case, there are two solutions with the same energy for this particular situation. Has anybody seen these sorts of things before? Does anybody know what they look like yet? Yeah? Have you ever seen these sorts of functions before? Yeah. anybody doing chemistry? If you're doing chemistry, these might look familiar because these are orbitals. This is where the shape of an orbital comes from. All chemistry comes essentially from solving the Schrodinger equation, although my colleagues might disagree. But that's the physics at the heart of it. Okay, so we've gone through second year undergraduate quantum physics. Let's now go to our final year course of undergraduate quantum physics. And this simply begins to look at what happens to an electron in three dimensions that's allowed to travel inside of a crystal. So we can think of a crystal as being, if we were to sort of zoom in and look at it, it would be this ordered array of atoms. Maybe you've seen sodium chloride, this sort of thing. That's an ordered crystal. Materials which are metal, like sodium, have an extra electron, which is free to sort of whiz around inside of the crystal. And this blue blob here is kind of representing an electron that's a wave running around this crystal. We can try and solve the Schrodinger's equation here, but it's very difficult because you can imagine each of these atoms here has a potential associated with it, and we need to worry about all that. But we also have to worry about this electron bumping into this electron because they'll repel each other, they have light charges. So the mathematics of it actually gets incredibly complicated. That is a real challenge, but mostly has been solved for many materials. And that's what took scientists sort of 1950s, 1960s, 1970s to do. And you might say, well, so what? This is, you know, all a bit abstract, we're talking about wave functions and quantum theory, and how does this impact my life? If I look at this quantum theory of solids, these are the things that come out of it. Quantum theory of solids gave us semiconductors. So understanding the quantum physics of an electron inside of a crystal allowed us to design and build semiconductors. And these semiconductors are the basis of essentially all modern electronics. So anybody who has sent a text today, anybody who has checked the internet today, has done so because we understand quantum physics of materials. So that's quite a profound impact. Now, where the field is now, what we're moving on to do, is trying to understand even more complicated crystals, even more complicated boxes. So one really fascinating material, which came out a few years ago, is this material, graphene. Some of you may have heard of this. This is essentially a one-dimensional sheet of carbon atoms, and the electrons inside of this are allowed to run along this sheet here, and they have very interesting properties. Many of which we understand, but some that we don't. But it's been proposed that this can form the basis of future technology. So this is an example of a flexible electronic chip that's built on graphene. And my colleagues tell me that flexible electronics, flexible displays based on graphene may be here in 10 to 15 years. Research that I'm interested in is a particular type of materials, and these are called superconductors. And this is something I want to spend the rest of my talk discussing. So superconductors are materials that have very unusual electrical and magnetic properties. And they have the potential to be used in many, many, I think, very interesting and useful applications. And to understand what makes a superconductor special, we need to go back to something called Ohm's Law, which some of you may have studied in school, and some of you will be studying shortly. Ohm's Law is essentially the fundamental law of an electric circuit. And so if I have, say, a battery here, which provides some voltage, and I have some resistor here inside my circuit, and a current flowing here, I can relate these three quantities by Ohm's law. Voltage is equal to current times resistance. And that's what happens in a normal electric circuit. And early on in the 20th century, people were measuring this electrical resistance. in lots of different materials. And they were measuring it as a function of temperature, so cooling things down just to see what happened. And this is the results from a lab headed by this person, Cameron Onis. And he was, his students were measuring the resistance of mercury. And they were measuring it, this is the original data here, but here's a schematic. And they saw that the resistance decreased. But at some temperature, very low temperature, can't quite read that, but it's around 7 or 8 degrees above absolute zero, they found that the resistance just disappeared, went to zero. So it didn't get very small, it just completely disappeared. And Cameron Onis, he was very upset by this. The students told him, and he said, "You guys are rubbish, you don't know what you're doing. I'm going to go down to the lab and do this experiment properly myself." And so he did, he found the same result, and said, "Oh, this is quite interesting, I think I'll publish it." And he did, he won the Nobel Prize. So as you know, a future generation of young scientists, there's a lesson in here. Make sure you get credit for your work. Because nobody remembers what happens to these poor graduate students who actually made the first discovery. But anyway, so what was discovered in this lab was a material, mercury in this case, where resistance vanished, it went to zero. And that is quite unusual. And that's one of the fundamental properties of superconductors. They have zero electrical resistance. The other interesting property about superconductors is that they exhibit something called diamagnetism. And what this means is if I take a superconductor, which is this blue ball here, and I apply a magnetic field, that's what those arrows are, essentially not very much happens at high temperatures, but when you cool this below its superconducting state, you find that the superconductor pushes out the magnetic field. It really doesn't want to have a magnetic field in there because it costs a lot of energy. And it forces that magnetic field to flow around the superconductor. And I have a demonstration here. So what I'll do is I'll just show you, this is I need to fill this up for just 1 second. So what we have here is a track that has magnets. The magnets are very strong rare earth magnets. And I've got some superconductors in here. I'm just going to pour some liquid nitrogen. And this is just going to get them below their superconducting transition time. So once I've done that, give it a moment to settle down. What you can see is if I take this material, this is a material called yttrium barium copper oxide. It's a superconductor with a transition temperature of about 90 Kelvin. And this nitrogen is about 77 Kelvin. So it's cooling it below its transition temperature. And when I put it on these magnets, you can see it floats. So the superconductor is exhibiting this Meissner effect that I mentioned. It's pushing out the magnetic field that's being applied to it, and it's actually levitating above the track. That's quite a neat little effect. And then, of course, as it warms up, then it falls back down to the track. So we can play with that perhaps a bit later after the talk. But that gives you an example of the second interesting property of superconductors, diamagnetism. So once we have these interesting materials, what sorts of things can we do with them? So one of the most, I think, useful applications of superconductors is in building large magnets. So if you imagine you have something called a solenoid, which looks like this. Imagine you have essentially a coil of wire, and you pass a current through it. This will generate a magnetic field. So it's a common phenomenon in electromagnetism. And the great thing about superconductors, because they have no resistance, you can put an awful lot of electrical current in a small space. So you can dump hundreds of amps inside of some of these materials and generate absolutely huge magnetic fields with a superconductor. So that's probably the main application of superconductors. And once you have these massive superconducting magnets, the first thing you would obviously go out and do is try and levitate things. And so here is an example of scientists levitating, in this case, a strawberry. So you're looking down the bore of a superconducting magnet. It's something like 7 or 8 Tesla, a very large magnetic field. And this is so strong, it's actually inducing a little bit of diamagnetism inside of the strawberry. It's actually the water inside the strawberry that's causing it. And this is causing the strawberry to levitate.
But of course, as visitors, we wouldn't stop there. We would proceed on to frogs, because that's the next most obvious thing. the same sort of thing is happening to this frog. It's being levitated inside of this giant superconducting magma. So I'm told the frog was not injured, maybe a bit dizzy, but not injured. But more seriously, people have been now investigating these materials to levitate larger instruments, so in particular trains. So both in China and Japan, they've developed prototype models of superconducting levitated trains. And you can imagine why this would be useful, because if you can levitate a train above the track, just like I did there, you would have no friction from the bearings, you'd have no friction from wheels rolling or on the rails. The only thing that would be impeding its progress is air resistance. A few years ago, on the test track in Japan, they set a new world record for a train to 600 kilometers an hour. I have a little video of that train. So this is Japan, you can see it whizzing along. This is an example of how one might use this diamagnetism, this levitation effect, to perhaps better, more useful purposes than levitating frogs. But this is still not sort of commercially rolled out in Japan. It's still in the testing phase. But one can imagine having a high-speed network of trains running on these superconductors. The drawback, of course, is that you still need to cool superconductors down. That's at the forefront of research, is trying to discover new materials that work at higher temperatures. So let's just move on to think a little bit about the materials themselves. So what materials actually exhibit superconductivity? So we saw Hammerling Onnes's graduate students discovered it in mercury. And in the 100 or so years since that discovery, we've actually found superconductivity in many, many materials. So things actually like graphite, even DNA, if you put a superconductor next to it, exhibits some superconductivity, which is very strange. But it seems to be the more complicated the materials, the higher the superconducting transition temperature will be. So simple elements, you might have a superconducting transition temperature at 1 or 2 or 5 Kelvin. If you go to materials like this one here, this is magnesium with two borons, it looks like this. The transition temperature goes all the way up to 35 Kelvin, which is a bit of a step, but still a long way from room temperature, which is around 300 Kelvin. But the closest that we've got so far are these materials, very complicated materials. This is yttrium, barium, copper oxide, the same material we just saw there. It looks like a bit of a sandwich of different atoms, but these materials will superconduct up to 150 Kelvin. That's halfway to room temperature. And if you look at sort of, this is a plot showing the highest known superconductor versus the year of discovery. There's mercury right there, sort of bumbling along. And in the 1980s, we discovered these layered superconductors like YBCO there, up to around 140, 150 Kelvin. But just last year, there's a new point on this plot, and this is a material called H2S, hydrogen or sulfur dihydride. So this is a material which is a gas. It's the thing that rotten eggs emit. But it turns out if you squeeze this in between two pieces of diamond to a very high pressure, it turns into a metal which will actually superconduct. And this is up at around 200 Kelvin, 185 Kelvin. So this is very much sort of ongoing research. People are trying to replicate this and search for other gases, perhaps hydrogen, which might superconduct all the way up to room temperature. So there's still a lot of room for discovery there. In the last few slides, I'm just going to discuss perhaps a few other potential uses for superconductors. So not just levitating trains, but superconductors themselves are already in quite a few mainstream technologies. So this technology here, this is an MRI scanner. Some of you may have seen one, some of you may have actually had an MRI scan. An MRI scan stands for magnetic resonance imaging. Essentially, it's just a giant superconducting magnet. That's what this thing is here. Not enough, strong enough obviously to make you levitate, but if your body is put in there, and you're subjected to pulses of electromagnetic radiation, you can measure the effects on various parts of your body, and you can build up an internal map of what's going on inside your body. So this is a new technique that has allowed doctors to diagnose things like cancer or help in sports injuries. And it's much easier to find a tumor this way than, you know, cutting somebody's head in half. So this is an example, perhaps, of how these obscure superconductors have really revolutionized the field of medicine and probably saved many lives. Superconductors have also been used extensively in scientific experiments, like the Large Hadron Collider. This is some of you may have heard about the discovery of the Higgs boson. This was the largest use of superconductors in the history of the world. A very large tube that was essentially a giant magnet, which would bend protons around in a circle, that allowed us to discover the Higgs boson. And one other potential use that people are researching right now is using superconductors to build what are called quantum computers. So these are computers which don't work in a sort of linear way that normal computers work, but use what's called massively parallel computation to solve problems which are more or less impossible to solve normally. People are investigating superconductors for the use there. So that brings me to the end of sort of the physics part of the talk. I guess the takeaway message is that often in physics, one goes off to do some fundamental research on a particular problem of interest. Right? You think of de Broglie and his waves versus particles. You think of Schrodinger and his equation and the people who were trying to solve for how an electron travels in a crystal. But nobody saw the internet coming out of this, or nobody saw semiconductors coming out of this, or MRI machines. And often there's a lag of several decades before this fundamental research is developed into technology. But one needs to do these fundamental experiments and understand nature at a fundamental level before one can go on and develop new technologies. And that, I think, is a take-home message for you as young scientists. Now, just before I take questions, I wanted to mention very briefly this excellent website here. This is Isaac Physics. Some of you may have heard about this. So this is a project which has been developed here in Cambridge University, designed to help young students aspiring to study physics at a university level. There are 500 or 600 good physics problems on here. It's free to join. If you are serious about going to university to study physics, practice. Get really good at problem solving. That would be my number one tip. So in the interest of time, I think I'll end here. I'd be happy to take a few questions. Thank you.
I've got a question.
So what's the state of quantum computing right now? How efficient is the processes that you can make?
Right. Good thing I have a slide for this. where is it? Yes. So just a little bit about a quantum computer. So the distinction between a quantum computer and a normal computer is normally you would have... can I have that projection back on? Is it gone? Good, thank you. So normally you store information in a normal computer as a bit. It can be either 0 or 1. And the way that you do a computation is you crunch a bunch of zeros and ones and you get some more zeros and ones. And that's basically how a normal computer works. In a quantum computer, the element of memory storage is what's called a qubit. And in a quantum computer, a qubit is in the state 0 and 1 at the same time. It's both. And it stays in that state until you do a measurement. And what this allows you to do, if you take these quantum bits and link them together, you can imagine it grows very, very quickly. It grows actually as 2 to the power of n. So you could have, if you put 2 qubits together, you could have 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, and then 3 qubits, etc., etc. So you can get a system that's incredibly complicated in all these states at the same time. And if you program that carefully, it can solve an equation by sampling all of the possible solutions instantaneously and giving you the right solution back. So you couldn't use it to run Microsoft Word, but you could use it to solve for the structure of a complicated protein. So that's why a quantum computer is interesting. Now, the difficult thing here from a technological point of view is how do you build these qubits? Because they're if they couple to the outside world, if a little bit of light hits them, if a bit of heat hits them, it will disturb this sort of quantum effect, and it will force it to choose a zero or one, and then you no longer have a quantum computer. So people have been using superconductors as the elements to form a qubit by putting superconducting currents in a circle. If it's traveling clockwise, it's a zero. If it's traveling counterclockwise, it's a one. And you can get these things to work relatively well if you have two bits or three bits. But as soon as you get more than that, we can't seem to get these things to last long enough to do a worthwhile calculation. But people are making lots and lots of progress. Superconductors are just one example of building a qubit. Other people are using light states inside of a diamond, purely inside of diamonds. So people are working at it from many different angles. If I talk to colleagues, they say, well, you know, 20, 30, 40 years, we'll have a working quantum computer. People are skeptical, but who knows, the field is moving very quickly.
Join me in your research and talk generally about quantum mechanics. What's your topic?
It's like I planted these questions here. One of the materials that I'm interested in is a class of materials that are based on iron-based superconductors. They have a sort of two-dimensional structure like the YBCO that we saw, but they have iron atoms in here. And if you ever talk to a physicist who is researching superconductivity, they'd say, it's never going to work if you have iron in there. Iron is magnetic, magnetism, superconductivity don't get along, stay away from all iron-based materials. And physicists did for about 100 years. Until some physicists in Japan said, well, let's just try it and see what happens. And they discovered this new class of superconductors with pretty high temperatures, 55 Kelvin. And so my colleagues and I, many of us are looking at different families of materials within containing iron and trying to figure out the mechanism, what makes them superconductors. Because that's a question that's not well understood in most superconductors.
I'm a chemist, so what's the oxidation state of the iron in that? Is that iron 2, iron 3?
It's iron 3, but you can have some vacancies in there as well. Yeah. So you could dope it by controlling.
Yeah. Yeah.
I just wondered if you could explain, because you were talking there earlier about a solenoid using a superconductor. So normally the premise of a solenoid is that you've got a ferromagnetic phase.
Yeah.
And so I just wondered if you could talk about what being the diamagnetic phase in there, what effect that has and why that's so useful.
Yeah, so in the superconducting magnets, you actually wouldn't have any core. So it would just be an air, what would be called an air core or a vacuum core. And that allows you to have a very large magnetic field concentrated in a small area, and then you do your experiments. You levitate frogs or you find your Higgs boson, that sort of thing. Whether you could then use that by putting in another material, so perhaps to make a transformer. I think some electrical engineers are looking at that, and I've seen some various proposals for that. But the fields are so large, what happens sometimes is you magnetize the core, and then that doesn't make a good transformer.
Okay, thank you. We're certainly out of time now. Can everyone remain in here, because we have something, we have another talk after this. But thank you very much.
And connect young scientists across the world. So as part of our annual conference, post-presentations, sharing their research and passions in science are a great part of that mission. So with no further ado, these are only part of the only some of the posters, people with posters. So you can all see them in the rooms, the seminar rooms. So up CC, down DD. Okay. So please welcome onto the stage Luke Gonsalves, Thomas Romain, David Rudolph, Chris Calabrulis, Sean Britton, of the Vertigo team of Sutton Grammar School.
We're Sutton Grammar, and this is Vertigo. So you're probably wondering. Sorry about this. So you're probably wondering, what is Vertigo? Well, Vertigo is an orientation and position and acceleration data logger, which, using the Earth's magnetic and gravitational fields, works out its orientation relative to a world frame, which means no matter how you rotate or move Vertigo, it'll always provide its data relative to the world axis. Okay. So we took Vertigo to Thorpe Park because roller coasters provide an extreme but controlled data. So, and also we
One of the things that we wanted to do using Vertigo is map right, and Vertigo measures its acceleration and as well as its GPS. So we have two ways of generating position if we integrate acceleration twice. Now both the integrated acceleration and GPS have a reasonable amount of uncertainty. So what we decided to do is use a Kalman filter to blend the two data sets together and get to better path estimation, shown by the blue line and the graphs. And as you can see, comparing to the mapping, it's quite accurate. Another thing we could do with Vertigo is analyze the safety of rides. And one of the ways we decided to do this is look at the g-force in the three orthogonal vectors throughout time. And looking at the graph, the maximum g-force in any direction is about 2.3 g's, and it's experienced for about 0.2 seconds. And comparing it with a study by Robert Thrall, you can see, marked by the red cross, that it is well within the human's limit to acceleration. Another thing we wanted to do is look at jerk. Now, jerk is the rate of change of acceleration in meters per second cubed. And most rides are not meant to be jerky. They want to minimize jerk, because jerk can cause uneven forces on your back and can lead to back problems, as well as compromise the integrity of the carriage and the track. So looking at it, you can see it's within quite a small range, between about 0.3 and minus 0.2 meters per second cubed. And looking at this, we can say that because of this, stealth, which is the ride we're analyzing, has a low jerk and is quite safe.
So this is where Vertigo becomes useful for the general public. What rides, and more specifically, what parts of the rides, are scientifically proven to be the most fun? Now, things that are fun are subjective to each people, but because of the wide variety of data that Vertigo can provide, we can tailor the results for each different person. So if you're like me and love speed, who loves speed?
Yeah.
So quite a lot of you then. The favourite part of stealth would be at this point here at the bottom, when the acceleration and when the velocity is the highest. Whereas if you like G-force, anyone like G-force?
Woo!
Few people. Then the best part for you would be as the pitch is coming up after the descent. And also, Yasir talked about jerk just on the slide before. In moderation, a lot of people actually like jerk, and some rides are specifically designed to do it because there's a tension release. It gives a tension release sensation.
That just means one more.
There's a tension and release experience which is often linked to euphoria.
Okay, one other thing quickly that we wanted to do with Vertigo is to be able to compare rides. And so this is Stealth and Colossus on Thorpe Park. I don't know if you guys know the rides, but here they are. Stealth has two distinct peaks, and this is representative because stealth has one large climb with an ascent and descent, which the two beats correlate to. Colossus has a lot of spins and corkscrews, which is why the wave looks somewhat sinusoidal, and the maximum's decreasing is actually representative of the fact that energy is lost throughout the ride.
So we can apply our method to any situation where having accurate data is useful. So we're currently working with the University of Southampton on finding the optimal angle attack for wingsuit gliders. Obviously, if you deviate too far off the optimal angle attack, you can enter a flat spin stall, and it obviously leads to death in most cases. So that's something we want to find and try and help with. We also think Vertigo could be used in performance-based sports. So rowing, for example, we can analyze the synchronicity of oar strokes of the whole rowing team and give them direct feedback on how to improve their technique. I think that's it because we are going to run out of time. I hope you've enjoyed our talk and got an insight into our...
Thank you for that. Okay. So the next talk is from Lachlan Bradley from the Judd School on backup earth.
Make sure this works. Okay. Hello, my name is Lachlan Bradley, and I want to talk to you about Mars. Currently, we're on Earth. It's a great place, but it's dangerous. We could be wiped out at any moment by nuclear war, superbugs, the AI singularity, asteroids, supervolcanoes, coronal mass ejections, anything, really. These threats are all limited to one planet. To survive these events, we need two. The solution is a self-sustaining Mars colony with the capacity to reboot human civilization should it become necessary. First things first, how do we get to Mars? Well, in space, because everything is in orbit, we don't measure distances with meters, really. We measure in delta V, or change in velocity. Using that equation there, we can calculate that to get from the surface of the Earth to low Earth orbit at 200 kilometers, we need about 7,400 meters per second of delta V. Unfortunately, air resistance is a thing, so we'll need to factor that in. This is what a typical transfer orbit will look like. It will take between half a year to a year and between 4 to 6 kilometers per second of delta V. So in total, we'll need 19,000 kilometers per second. This is manageable. Apollo 11, that needed 15 kilometers per second because they also had to get back. Using the Tsiolkovsky rocket equation, we can calculate that for an equivalent payload, so about 15 tons, we will need to put 52,000 kilograms of stuff into low Mars orbit. We can use the Vesper rocket, which is very efficient, but it only works outside of atmosphere. So once we're in low Earth orbit, we'll need 63,000 kilograms. Unfortunately, because we can't use such an efficient rocket to get off Earth, we'll need normal rocket, which means we need a lot more fuel to get from the surface to low Earth orbit. But nobody said we had to fit everything into 15 tons. SpaceX has developed a reusable booster. We can use that and send several dozens of missions over the course of a few decades. So what should we bring? Well, the minimum viable population is basically the lowest number of people that a species needs to survive. Human population has been as low as 10,000 before, so we know it can be done with that many. Most biologists tend to put it around 160, but to start off with, we only really need about 8 people just to make sure everything's running. We can expand on that later. Hopefully, we won't have died by then. The problems with Mars, there are many. There's basically no atmosphere, a lot less gravity, it's really cold, and you take a lot more radiation. But most of these things, you can deal with them, so you can bring your own air, make sure everything's pressurized, you can hide behind lead shielding to block out most of the radiation, but you still need to eat. On Mars, everyone will be vegetarian, not because of morals, but because if you want to bring beef, you have to bring the food for the beef, and that means more fuel. Instead, grow food with plants. Using aeroponics is experimental at the moment, but it could increase efficiency by 1400%. You'll want to grow, what Motley did on Mars is fine because you can still do conventional farming on Mars, but if you had had aeroponics, you could have fed 8 people. You want to bring sweet potato. With conventional farming, you can grow 7 calories per square meter per day. With aeroponics, you can get up to 80. It takes about 90 days to mature, so you'll want to bring more calorie-dense food along with you for the time being. You'll need about 120 kilograms of food per person. Again, that's manageable. Air is mostly nitrogen, which doesn't do much, so we don't need to worry about that. But oxygen you need to survive, and it's used up. What you do is you electrolyze water into its constituent hydrogen and oxygen, and because gases take up a lot of space, you only actually need that much ice. I'm going to skip through it because I'm running a bit behind, sorry about that. Electricity, solar panels, and you can also use nuclear energy to make heat. But everybody dies. If anything breaks, electrolysis breaks, no oxygen. Everybody dies. Your crops suffer blight, no food. Everybody dies. It takes the last chance to window comes around once every 2 and a bit years. If you don't have enough stockpiles, everybody dies. And if Earth dies, there are no spare parts. And when something breaks, everybody dies. Vitamins are a concept about things you can't make in space because you don't have the equipment. There are 3 sort of stages to a Mars colony. Only an Earth independent can you make these vitamins and survive if Earth is nuked or something. 3D printers, you can use those. Technology is coming along very quickly. And you can make the raw material, blueberries, not actual blueberries, but they're made of iron ore, and you can find them naturally on the Martian surface. So it's all good, right? Wrong. It's not going to happen. In 1961, JFK said we should go to the moon, not because it's easy, but because it's hard. And it was hard. The NASA budget, it was 4% of the federal budget. But since then, it's only a tenth of that, because there's no real reason to do this. There's no economic reason to go to Mars, apart from a few mavericks. You don't have anyone invested in the future of humanity. And I don't have a solution for that, because that's politics. Why spend money on this when you can spend money on a border wall? By the time there's an actual threat, if we haven't already started, it'll be too late. The sad truth is, there is no money while there is still time. And by the time there's money, it'll be too late.
Thank you. Next up is particle identification using CERN's open archive by Marcel Dorian Covat and Lajos Palanki from Milestone Institute, Budapest.
Hello everyone, my name is Marcel, and this is my partner Lajos. We are coming from Hungary, and I would like to present our particle physics research to you now. So, how is it even possible that high school students are able to do something in particle physics? I mean, the standard model, which describes the behavior of fundamental particles, is one of the most complicated mathematical theory ever devised. How can we approach that at all? So it turns out that the experimental side of particle physics concentrates more on data analysis and computer science rather than rigorous mathematics. So by learning how to use the CERN framework, as you might know, CERN is one of the largest research institutions in particle physics. So by learning how to use their methods, we were able to gain a little insight to a particle physicist's job. So we analyzed measurement of data taken in a particle accelerator, and we tried to figure out what happens inside the particle accelerator. And so our project focused on the weak nuclear force mediator particle, which is called the Z boson, and we focused on a special decay of the Z boson. So how does the particle accelerator work anyway? So there are 2 proton beams colliding at velocities approaching the speed of light.
So the high energy of the collision makes the protons explode, and there's an emission of lots of particles. And for example, the CMS detector is designed to measure these particles' properties and store this data in the computer system of CERN. And the CMS also maintains an open archive where they make the necessary software tools and analysis tools and also data sets available for anyone to use them for their own purposes. So what do we have to do? How do we find an elementary particle? So spoiler alert, we look for its decay products. So the Z boson decays into two muons. A muon is an elementary particle also, but that can be detected with CMS. So a Z boson decays into two oppositely charged muons. So we have to look for collisions that produce two oppositely charged muons. So how do we do that? So we wrote a program that accesses the CMS datasets and selects the events with the two muons that could have come from a Z boson collision. There are conditions that they should pass. After that, we calculate the D muon's invariant mass, because in particle physics, a particle is identified by its mass. So we use Einstein's famous equation. As you can see, if we know the energy of the particle and the momentum, so P of the particle, we can calculate back its invariant mass. So what do we do after that? We run this selection program on lots of collision events. So we ran it on around 30 million events, and which results in a mass spectrum. And in the mass spectrum, there are peaks, so that correspond to the original particle that the muons came from. And this is a distribution, so it's not like just one line. So we have to fit a distribution to actually calculate the invariant mass of the original particle, and this allows us to identify that. So this is what I was talking about. So if you fit a function in this region of the mass spectrum, you can calculate the Z's invariant mass, which is a 90 times bigger than the proton's mass. The gamma parameter is the so-called width of the distribution that relates to the lifetime of the particle, so we calculated that as well. The other graph shows the muon trajectories inside the CMS. So the coordinates describe the space inside the detector, and each point refers to muons in that. So as you can see, there are whiter regions with less muons in the detector, and that part of the detector is less sensitive to measurements, and this is most probably due to the non-functioning of these parts, which is non-functioning parts at the time of the data taking, which is in 2011, according to the open data site. So, and the Z boson is obviously not the only particle that can decay into a D muon. So we were able to identify several other particles as well. So these are called mesons, which are composite particles that can also decay to a muon. And we could calculate their mass as well. So actually CERN did also a lot of measurements on these particles in invariant mass. So this is the comparison of our results to the literal values, and you can see we are in range. So our results are in accordance with the literal values. So the interesting thing is that our statistical error is much bigger than CERN's statistical error, and this is mainly due to that we don't have so 30 million events might sound a lot, but in particle physics it's not. So for example, the famous Higgs boson was found after analyzing around 1 trillion events. So this is just really a version, very, very small portion, but this could be, the error could be minimized by analyzing more data. So if you have any questions, please ask us, and we are very eager to share you the details of our project. And thank you very much for letting us present here.
I have one question. If you have questions for the other two that have been, please feel free to ask them in the room. So, any questions? Okay. Okay. So. Thank you for that. That was really good. Okay, so next we have translocal time from Virat Lakhna from ELTE Radnoti Nicholas High School.
Yeah. Hello everyone, I'm from Budapest also. There has been quite a few physics related lectures, but I draw something in connection with biology. I'm part of this project called Translocatome, which is a novel tool for drug target discovery, and it's based on systematic analysis of protein translocation. It is currently in ongoing research. First of all, Translocatome is a comprehensive database of translocating proteins and their interactions, and its reliability is because its basis is manually curated. That's where I joined, and that's what I did most of the time. And based on a machine learning algorithm, there are predicted proteins added to this, and these together can be used to systematically analyze and model the role of translocating proteins in cellular signaling, and we hope that this will lead to the discovery and prediction of potential new drug targets. And I mentioned translocation, which I would like to define now. This figure I made myself because, according to our definition, there wasn't any on the internet, and this really helped me imagine it, and I hope to happen too. So we define translocation from a systems biology perspective, and this means that we consider protein translocation a regulated movement between subcellular compartments of a protein of a given post-translational state. And during this, its interactions and functions are changed. And there are certain limitations to this definition. So we excluded all those protein movements that happen during the end phase when the nuclear membrane disintegrates and then remodels. Also, we excluded any co-translation or translocation, the delivery processes of to the protein's final location, the protein degradation, downregulation, and the passive diffusion of proteins. And so based on this, we created a data set that consists of a manually created data set, which is currently still building, but now it's quite huge. We have over 200 proteins that are translocating, and 145 proteins that are not translocating. We mainly use these three bases and research articles for this, and we built a big database. And next to this, we have an interaction network, which is based on complete and other database. And these together were used for the machine learning algorithm, which predicted us 973 proteins to be translocating. And the reviewing of those is still going on. And we are currently at the stage of still building the data set, also continuing this manual curation and adding data complexity scores and evidence scores to the proteins. The first means that we give a score to the protein based on how complex the data is, how detailed it is, and we give the evidence score based on its reliability, whether it is experimentally validated or just a predicted protein. Also, we are based on these predictions on the data set, we're building a model which is hoped to model a cancer framework, and with the in-house developed artificial intelligence guided simulation tool, we would like to simulate the pathological states of the cells, and this can show us some potential drug targets in the cells. Next to this, we are building this website, which is now available and accessible for everyone, and quite detailed, and the link is on my poster too, so you can check it out. Thank you. Do you have any questions? Yes.
So how did you get involved in this project in the first place?
actually my mentor in Milestone Institute told me about it, and I thought it's really interesting, and I asked them if I could join, and I got the opportunity, and meet with them every week, every second week, and burn on the project.
When will this be available for use?
You mean the website? Yeah. Oh, the website is running now, so...
But the
date is in January. I don't know yet.
Yeah. What's it like working in science and on this project?
First, for me, it was a bit scary because there are PhD students and university students around me, so it was scary, but they are very friendly and helpful, so now I feel more involved, and I feel that I can really contribute to this project, which is really great.
Does it make you
want to
pursue a career in this?
Yes, of course. It really convinced me that it's interesting. Thank you very much.
Okay, so up next is Anton Farmer from the Judd School presenting What If Prime Factorization Was Easy?
All right, my name is Anton Farmer. I'm from the Judd School. That's with an A, not an E, just so you know. Unfortunately, I only learned that I was supposed to do a presentation about a week ago, so I apologize in advance for the lack of content. But my presentation is called What If Prime Factorization Was Easy? But first, I really need to tell you what I mean by an easy problem. So I'm going to give you an example of an easy problem, which would be sorting numbers. So here we have some numbers being represented by their sizes here. One way that we could sort them is to go through and look at the first pair and say, are they in order? Yes, so we leave them alone. So let's go to the next pair. Are they in order? No. So let's swap them. And we're going to do the same thing again and again. And since we actually had to do swaps, we need to go through again and make sure that they're in order. So we go through one more time. And now we have an ordered list. Now, what was particularly easy about that? Well, to show you what I mean, we need to count the steps and on average. In general, this is going to take something like n squared steps for some list of size n. Now, it might be half n minus 2 n, but what really is important there is the n squared term. In fact, a computer scientist says O n squared using big O notation. Can we do better than this? Yeah. There are things like merge sort, which has n log n time. You don't really need to know what log n is if you don't know that. And then there's the incredible radix sort, which uses O n time, but depends on the size of the numbers you're comparing. But another question could be, can we do worse than this? Of course we can. We can do far worse. An example of this is BOGO sort, also known as stupid sort or monkey sort, which is O n factorial time. This sort involves throwing your cards up into the air and hoping they land in order, repeating it until it works. Okay? So what there really is there's this kind of duality between very, very slow algorithms and very, very fast algorithms. It's easy to make an algorithm slow, but it's really difficult to make a fast algorithm. In fact, it's so difficult that there's a theorem known amongst computer scientists as the full employment theorem, which says that essentially we may never find the fastest algorithm to do something. I don't know if that's the best name for a theorem ever, but it is in my opinion. So what does this have to do with prime numbers? Well, the best factorization algorithm that we actually have is of this order. You don't really need to know what that is exactly, only that it is ridiculously slow and terrible. But what if this wasn't the case? What if we could do this just immediately? Well, security these days, especially online, relies on the fact that it's actually really, really difficult to factorize numbers. If it were an easy problem like this, it would be a security apocalypse. But not only that, anything that does this in such an efficient way would have to be an absolute mathematical miracle. But most importantly, this entire idea is about P versus NP problems, which is to say, essentially, can we difficult versus easy problems. Prime factorization is thought to be an example of something that can only be solved in exponential time, that's 2 to the power something time. However, if this were the case, then this would be reasonably strong evidence to suggest otherwise. So in conclusion, we don't really know if this is possible. In fact, with quantum algorithms, we have something called Shor's algorithm, which is a quantum factorization algorithm, which if we have a number of n bits, then it's n squared log n log log n, which is not very fast, but compared to even the best traditional factorization algorithm, it's lightning. So the future of this kind of problem is unknown. And in conclusion, things are hard, things are difficult, and maybe it's better than that. We do have a lot of time, about 60 seconds, so if anyone has any questions whatsoever, I'd be glad to answer them. Anything that pops into your head, there are no stupid questions. Go ahead.
So you're saying that, if there was an efficient algorithm for prime factorization, it would cause a security disaster.
Yes, exactly.
So are there any suggestions how to solve that if that happens?
Well, we do have, in general, security is based on problems that are very easy to make but hard to undo and solve. Prime multiplication is one of them because it's very easy to multiply two large prime numbers, but it's incredibly difficult, as we've seen, to factorize them. But an example of something that might be able to be used would be hashing, which is essentially destruction of information, but in a methodical way. It's quite complicated and I won't explain it entirely, but we are looking for problems like that. Anything else?
Let's go back.
Shor's algorithm, yes. This is not a traditional algorithm. You need a quantum computer to run this. So you shouldn't worry about this yet. We'll see in the future if this happens.
How are we able to come up with this theory?
I'm sorry, what do you mean?
But how was this theory found?
Do you mean generally in terms of how long it takes, or the fact that it's difficult to produce this?
How you came across the theory?
This is kind of a well-known thing in computer science. This is called asymptotic analysis, which is this kind of thing, then a number here. But this was first introduced by John Nash. Has anyone heard of John Nash? Yeah. Game theorist, he actually came up with this idea of actually using problems that we've only found very slow algorithms to solve for security. And so it was kind of his idea to introduce this type of thing. So yeah.
How long do you think it'll be before Shor's algorithm becomes a reality and we are faced with this crisis?
I think we said earlier that some people say it's 30, 40 years until a quantum computer comes around, but I really do not know. I would, for now, just be worried about more human security flaws, like don't tell your password to anyone, please. and use different passwords for everything. But at least for now, you don't need to worry about this. Is that everything? No more questions? Anyone else? Thank you very much.
So we're at the end of the post presentations for this session. I hope you had a good lunch. So we have the second session of Post Presenters now. First up is medical advances in the First World War from Aidan Verdi from the Judd School.
In the Peninsular War of 1808 to 1814, 750 people died of disease to every one of direct to every 100 of direct combat. In the First World War, only 70. This can be attributed to many factors, including, of course, the immense new firepower of 20th century weapons, but also, crucially, the unprecedented advances in medicine during the First World War. Firstly, I'd like to thank the Young Scientist Journal for allowing me to present today. World War I has become a hot topic as the UK commemorates the centenary of her most important war. Therefore, I decided to conduct a review of the medical advances during the First World War. The scale and severity of wounds was of a level unseen ever before. On the first day of the Somme, 24,000 casualties had passed through the medical services. Treatments had to be effective and efficient, driving innovation in the medical field. This presentation mainly focuses on surgery, but my post has information on the other aspects. Perhaps the most crucial innovation was plastic surgery. Shards of shrapnel could manage to tear a face apart. The suffering felt by victims was overpowering. They lost their identity and struggled to reintegrate into society. Often, their families couldn't even look at them. Gillies opened his own hospital to mainly treat those with facial wounds. To overcome the great challenges he faced, he invented new techniques, new and revolutionary techniques to repair the face. The end results are nothing short of amazing. He was inspired by concepts from all over the world, but these were still widely regarded as science fiction. His most famous technique, the tube pedicle, which is on the left, involves stitching the reconstructed flap into a tube and then attaching it to the target site, preventing infection because of the waterproof skin layer and maintaining a lateral blood supply to the growing tissue. Most of the casualties with head or torso wounds died almost instantaneously before they could reach medical services. So most of their casualties were actually limb casualties. So there was a mortality of around 80% for those with compound femoral fractures in 1914 to 1915, treated with variants of the outdated Liston splints. Surgeons and medics had to change their inadequate splinting procedures, eventually adopting the Thomas splint, invented by Hugh Owen Thomas. Mortality of the compound femoral fracture reduced to 20%. Although Thomas died 23 years before World War I, the vast majority of his insights were first realised in the First World War with the action of his nephew, Sir Robert Jones. Thomas is widely regarded as the father of orthopaedic surgery. At the start of the war, wounds to the abdomen were not operated upon. It was believed that the invasive surgery was not effective and instead caused damage to the patient. Punctures to the intestines by bullets or shrapnel would cause peritonitis, or inflammation of the peritoneum, a layer in the abdomen, and septicemia, which was infection of the blood. Both conditions are highly dangerous, even with today's medicine. After analysis of mortality rates and tests to explore the efficacy of this abdominal surgery, it was found that surgery was much more effective. Decisions to operate quickly and repair damage to the intestine saved many lives. Anesthesia has changed very much since the time of the First World War. Intravenous general anesthesia was around but not widely used. Instead, anesthesia was generally dripped from a mask or inhaled as a vapor. The exception is nitrous oxide, or laughing gas, which is inhaled as a gas from pressurized cylinders. By 1917, surgical teams often used the specialist anaesthetist, making surgery safer and more pleasant. Shriver Magill, who worked in Gillies' hospital, developed endotracheal anaesthesia. So this presentation only looked at surgery in the First World War, but there were obviously many more advances, including the first blood transfusions, and the first wide use of x-rays, the Spanish flu, the development of modern psychiatry in response to shell shock, and triage and ethics, which are very important to the medical field, especially AME. And my host is in room B2.
and thank you for listening.
Do you think these medical inventions, medical developments, would have happened without the World War?
Well, it's a hard question, and I would say that for the most part, yes, but it would have taken a much longer time. There wasn't a need for most of this because, well, things like plastic surgery, there was no need for it because there were barely any wounds to the face which required things like that. And also, the amount of surgery undertook was immense. Thousands of casualties had to be. There were thousands of operations on thousands of casualties in field hospitals in France and things. So they basically had a necessity of needing to be efficient and effective. So I would say. No, I would say that these would have come around eventually, but at a much, much slower rate.
So, shall we make more wars to boost the research?
From an ethical standpoint, obviously no. And from my personal view, no, I don't.
Thank you. Yeah. So next up is biggest threat superbugs from Darpan Reki and Saitaram Suresh from Loughborough Grammar School.
Hi guys, my name is Darpan and this is Sai, and this is our presentation on antibiotic resistance.
So, according to the World Health Organization, 10 million people will be dead in the year 2050 caused by superbugs. So we've got two types of bacteria, gram-positive and gram-negative. Gram-negative have a high lipopolysaccharide content, which makes it harder for antibiotics to affect them, and this makes them more prone to becoming antibiotic resistant. So how did they develop resistance? Well, you've got random mutation. Really? That's probably a typo. Okay, you've got random mutation, which affects the base sequence, so it changes the DNA, which affects the gene, and it can produce non-functional or functional proteins. So in one case, it can produce a functional enzyme which breaks down antibiotics, making them antibiotic resistant. So, they're passed on in two ways, horizontal and vertical transmission. Vertical transmission is just asexual reproduction, also known as binary fission in bacteria. So they produce identical daughter cells which have the same DNA, so therefore they're going to be antibiotic resistant. Horizontal transmission, you've got two bacterial cells. One's going to be antibiotic resistant, it's going to insert its conjugation tube into the other one and pass on a replicated plasmid which contains the antibiotic resistant gene.
So, as Sai mentioned, the World Health Organization predicts that by 2050, around 10 million people will die annually due to superbug-related infections. Currently, it's about 700,000, but this isn't actually a completely accurate figure, as currently there's no comprehensive and standardized method to measure the amount of superbug deaths that happen globally. Which is one of the major issues that we face when tackling superbug issues. We don't know how widespread the problem is. There's a lot more information up there, but we don't really have the time for it. So one of the main superbugs that are causing a threat to our world right now is called C. diff, or Clostridium difficile, which is classified as urgent by the CDC. The main mechanism which goes about killing you basically is death by dehydration, mainly caused by diarrhea. And in the year 2000, it developed a resistance to a group of antibiotics called fluoroquinolones, which resulted in a 400% increase in its mortality rate. So what the fluoroquinolones were meant to do was to attach to the B subunit, which is the white bit there, which would prevent the enzyme, which is responsible for supercoiling chromosomes, from hydrolyzing ATP ATP, so there was no energy for the enzyme to actually allow the process to occur. But to treat this, there's another wide range of antibiotics called beta-lactams, whose main mechanism is to inhibit the enzymes which are in the bacterial cell wall and prevent it from forming cross-linkages. So the cell wall will basically break down and would make the bacterial cell really permeable to pretty much anything. So naturally it would die. So what they mainly use, beta-lactams, is a chemical group called the beta-lactam ring, which is just up there. So with the tetrahedral structure there, it's got disproportionate bond angles. So the bond between the nitrogen and the bottom left carbon is there's a tension there. And so when it gets into the bacterial cell wall, it'll break down and attach to the enzyme called DD transpeptidase, which is in the cell wall, and therefore it won't be able to form the cross linkages and the bacterial cell will naturally die.
So how are we going to save these 10 million people is a real question. We've come up with a theoretical solution, and it's called passive humoral polyclonal antibody therapy. So what we're going to do is take the antigen off an antibiotic-resistant bacteria, so we're not actually injecting the bacteria into a human body or a host animal. We're going to take this antigen, inject it into their bloodstream, which can trigger an immune response. Trigger an immune response. Your body's got many B lymphocytes that have antibodies on the surfaces which are complementary to many epitopes on the antigens. So what epitopes are? They are sections of an antigen. So say my tire is an antigen. You've got the golden stripes, which is an epitope, and these flags, which is the other epitope. So when we inject them in, you're going to have these different B cells. Then we're going to take a sample of blood out of them, purify it, and then we're going to form something called hybridoma cells. I don't know if you have a picture, but anyways, hybridoma cells. And the good thing about them is they can produce antibodies outside the human body. So we're going to form hybridoma cells, mass produce antibodies, and when someone gets infected by an antibiotic-resistant bacteria, we can look at the antigen and choose antibodies which are complementary to these epitopes on those antigens. So theoretically, this should work, but we haven't tried it yet, so there's ethical issues involved with it and side effects.
Yep, thank you very much. Yeah, so, yeah, we have time for any questions there, hold on. Right.
Thank you.
So, next up is the iGEM project from Katie Gibbs, Alfie Scopes, and Adam Fiddler from the Judd.
So welcome everyone. I'm Katie, and we're from the Judd School, and we represent 1/5 of the Judd iGEM team. So what is iGEM? iGEM is a synthetic biology competition where teams from around the world genetically modify microorganisms to do something useful. So synthetic biology is a relatively new field of science, and it involves the design and construction of new biological entities, such as enzymes, cells, and genetic circuits. It can also be the redesign of existing biological systems. So iGEM started in 2003 at MIT with only 5 university teams competing. It has since grown to over 300 teams and recently including high schools. So every year in November, teams travel to Boston to present what they've done in a giant jamboree and hopefully win medals is the end game.
So let's talk a little bit about our idea. Our idea is based on the fact that over 2 billion people in developed and non-developed countries suffer from anemia, and that's mainly pregnant women and children. Anemia causes pale skin, heart conditions, tiredness, and also reduced cognitive ability, so it's not very nice. An issue that goes hand in hand with this is the fact that many countries hand out iron supplement tablets prophylactically to pregnant women and children, whether they're anemic or not. So that sounds like a good idea, but iron overdose is just as harmful as anemia. So we need to find a test that is easy to use and can show whether you need iron supplement tablets or whether you're anemic. So that's basically our idea. Our idea was to create a home testing kit accessible by everyone, And we're hoping, with the lab work that we've done, it could be taken forward to create a paper-based cell-free system using saliva as an example, so that it's non-invasive. And a semi-quantitative colour change will represent the amount of iron that's in your saliva. Furthermore, we hope that the components of the bacteria that we have genetically engineered can be freeze-dried into paper, activated using water, so it's accessible and very easy to use by anyone in the world. So I'm going to hand over to Katie to talk about our construct now.
Okay, so moving on to our genetic construct. For our promoter, we needed an iron-sensitive promoter. So bacteria naturally produce a protein called fer, which in the presence of iron ions, dimerizes and binds to a fer binding site. So our chosen promoter was PACEB, which contained a fer binding site. Okay. Sorry, we did have animation. But so if no iron is present, the RNA polymerase transcribes plasmid 1 and the purple arrow, LACI, is produced. So this protein then binds to the promoter on plasmid 2, the LACI regulated promoter, and this inhibits any further downstream transcription. So which means the MLCP on plasmid 2 can't be transcribed and we don't get a blue colour because iron isn't present. If iron is present, fer proteins dimerize, so two come together, and they bind to the promoter on plasmid 1. And this inhibits the transcription of LACI. So without LACI, plasmid 2 can be transcribed, and the blue chromoprotein, which is MLCP, can be coded for. So all of this results in a positive blue colour if iron is present.
Thank you. In terms of lab work, we faced a few problems involved with being the first state school from the UK to attempt this, such as having to apply for a permit that we weren't aware of. But we've overcome a lot of these problems and we've achieved some impressive results. So we ordered the constructs that you were just shown from IDT, an online company, and they send them to us in the form of plasmids, which are circular loops of DNA found in bacteria. But in order to submit our part to the iGen registry of parts, we need to cut out our gene construct and stick it into the iGen backbone. And the cutting out of genes is called digestion. And we accomplish this with two digestive enzymes, EcoL1 and PST1. And once we cut out our gene, we need to stick it into the iGen backbone, which we've already cut with the same enzymes, leaving complementary sticky ends that combine to each other. So that's ligation. And we did that with two ligase enzymes. So once we've got our gene into the right plasmid, we transformed it into competent cells, which are bacteria cells ready to take up DNA. And after we've done that, you can see in the top right, blue colonies have formed, showing that the gene that we'd ordered was doing its correct job and it turned bacteria blue. After that, there should be more pictures, but there aren't. We grew them in different iron concentrations, and you're going to have to take my word for it, but they changed colour slightly. Not quite enough, so that's our future job. We're going to be doing more testing with different iron concentrations to make sure that it is responding as accurately as we want it to. And we also had to make sure that we created exactly the right gene, and we had them, for example, ligated two backbones together or something like that. So we ran gel electrophoresis, which is basically chromatography, but for DNA. So the heavier, longer DNA doesn't move through gel as quickly, so it forms a sort of ladder of lengths of DNA. So we can check exactly how long what we've made was, and because we wrote the base sequence for it, we knew that we created exactly the right thing. So now all we need to do is extract that and send it to iGen in the post, and then go in November to Boston to present our work. Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions before we finish? In terms of finding whether other teams are doing similar things is very difficult because there are so many teams in the past as well. iGen's been running for a long time now. But if someone could take our research forward and actually create a paper-based system that is non-invasive, it would be extremely helpful because it's cheap and it would not require medical professionals as well. So it's not It doesn't help out that much. Basically, it tells you that you need to go to the doctor or you need to take iron supplement tablets or whatever. But in terms of letting people know from less developed countries what they need to do, I think it would be extremely helpful.
What inspired you to go into this competition thing?
So basically, we had a teacher that went to this the Giant Jamboree in Boston last year. She told us all about it, and she offered it to a number of students, and that's how we became inspired by it. So there's a lot of people going for this team. There's 15 of us overall, but there's a lot more people that wanted to get onto the team. But that's basically it. It was information handed from her, basically. So, yeah.
Anything else?
Thank you very much.
Thank you for that. Okay, so next one is paying closer attention to the patient's condition and the effects of it. From Anna Esther Timar from Milestone Institute of Budapest.
Medicine has come a long way in treating cancer patients. However, to this day, we still cannot say that we can cure the disease in most cases. And when one of my what most people don't think of is the doctor's role in treating these patients, because if they pay more attention to the conditions, they could actually help the patient extend her life. And one of my acquaintances got diagnosed with rectal cancer 2 years ago, and it occurred to me that her son is a general practitioner, and when she passed away this September, she more than tripled the average survival rate, which was 5.3 months. For those patients living with rectal cancer. And so I made my hypothesis, which is having a close acquaintance working in the medical field can help lengthen a patient's life if that acquaintance is paying close attention to the patient's condition. First, I would like to give some background info on the patient, since this is a case study. She was a female and aged 80. She had a background of type 2 diabetes and lymphedema, and these conditions alone can be a reason for concern, since these actually damage the circulatory system. And this presentation aims to show that it is important to have a good doctor, and that it is a problem with healthcare that we do not have doctors who can pay closer attention to their patients. I brought two examples. First one being when the patient had symptoms of a brain hemorrhage, she was taken to a hospital's neurology ward, where she was examined, but the examinations couldn't show anything, since the problem was of a gastroenterological order origin. Sorry. So then she was taken to a gastroenterology ward, where it was found that she had lack of potassium and sodium in her system, and that was the problem, which they could cure, and then she was back to her original state. The second example is when the patient fell and suffered a femoral neck fracture, which can take a toll on the body if the body is of an elderly, since the rehabilitation time takes a long time, and it is important that the time is minimized. And so when the doctor helped her getting the wound bandaged properly, therefore stopping the risk of blood clots forming. It was especially nice that he could pay attention to that, because blood clots can cause death, and the hospital staff could not pay attention to bandaging the leg properly. And I brought this graph, which tells the results of having a good doctor. You can see that longer life, obviously, if you have longer life, you get to be there for your family, and if you get the right treatment, then you have a bigger chance of recovery, or a faster recovery if that is possible. And having a good doctor can actually mean that hospital staff can pay more attention to their patients, and then you get more satisfied patients and better healthcare. And then you have less pain, which leads a more active lifestyle, and that actually lengthens a patient's life as well, and happier patients. Acknowledgement, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you for that. So next is, and this is the last one actually, is Isha Wahid from the Perse School, presenting about mutant lymphocytes.
Hi, I'm Isha, and I'll be talking, oh gosh.
Hi everyone, this is one of the joys of live broadcasting. And I just wanted to take this opportunity actually to say that I hope you're enjoying yourselves.
Woo!
Yes? And also to say that apart from a little bit of input from me, okay, quite a bit over the last few weeks, this entire journal is run by students. And I don't know if everyone in the room appreciates that. Not just the writing that they've been doing in the journal, which I hope you've been reading, not just the research which we've just been hearing about, which is awesome, isn't it? Yes. Not only editing the articles that go into the Young Scientist Journal, but also producing the journal, running the website, developing the website, running our marketing, running our outreach, which Channon does, and if your school is interested in becoming a hub school of the Young Scientist Journal, where you can perhaps get together students on a weekly, fortnightly, monthly basis, both from your school and possibly from other partner schools locally. That's something that people like Channon would love to talk to you about. So all of these roles are conducted by the students themselves, which I think is awesome. And so for all of you in purple t-shirts today, and all of you in countries around the world, which is where our team is gathered from, let's have a big round of applause for all of them. That was just about the right length.
I meant to do that.
It's your plan.
Hi again. So I did this, the research project that I was taking part, that was a part of was
as part of a Gold Crest Award. And just a bit of background information before I get into the specifics of it. I was looking at cytotoxic T cells, which are essentially a type of immune cell, which work by secreting specific proteins to kill target cells. And in scientific literature in the past, it has been theorized that if you increase the capacity of these T cells to kill, then you can actually use them to target several cancers, and it has been proven to be the case in breast and colorectal tumors. So I did this by using something called knockouts. This is essentially where you alter the genome or the DNA sequence a bit, and comparing the results I got from that to wild-type mice or normal healthy mice. This is useful because, like I said earlier, you can use this to model human disease and help create potential therapeutic targets for the future. So this is a complicated setup, but essentially I got a 96-well plate to perform something called a killing assay to test the T cell function. And in triplicate, I put in the T cells that I wanted to test, as well as the target cells that I wanted them to kill, alongside control rows to take into account any background killing that would be present. So using this setup, I could then quantify the results I obtained and plot a graph. So the first gene that I tested was something called USB30. And although I was looking for an increase in CTL function, I actually found the opposite. So the red lines represent the knockouts, and you can see that there's a distinctive decrease in the function of the T cells after knocking out the gene. Another gene that I looked at was FAM160. Not much is known about this gene, and again, similarly, I couldn't really find a trend. There's a bit of overlap there, and you can't really say that it's statistically significant. But obviously, science is a learning curve. I didn't give up there. I heard about a different gene called BAT2. Now, in scientific literature, they'd already shown that this gene has a confirmed increase on the T cell function. So I performed a different experiment called Western blotting. I don't have enough time to go into the experimental details of it, but essentially I was looking to see whether a specific protein called perforin would be in increased amounts in the cell samples. And if you look at the first blue blot, you can see in the last four columns that the knockouts have more distinct bands, which correlates to an increased amount of the protein that I was looking at. So on the right hand side is just a control row to show that all the proteins have been loaded in exactly the same way. So I could use this to create this graph, and as you can see, that the amount of perforin in the knockouts is definitely significantly increased, which could potentially mean that if there's more protein to kill the target cells, that more of them can be killed. So, in conclusion, I was able to further my understanding of CTL biology. Although I didn't find anything exciting with the FAM160 gene, I did, however, realize that it did not have a major role to play in T cell function. Similarly, although I wasn't expecting a decrease in the USB30 knockouts, it can now be used to target other diseases, so for example, autoimmune disorders, where you would want your immune system to be less active. And similarly, back to, like I said at the beginning, there's now potential, it can now be considered a potential therapeutic target for the future. And I hope that scientists after me can take this further. Thank you. If there are any questions, I'll have to answer them.
Are you interested in taking this further yourself?
I actually don't think I'd have the resources to do it, because now that I've identified the genes of interest, I'd probably, this is kind of getting to, you know, like top levels
science PhD standards, so at my age, I wouldn't be able to do it. But I'd be quite keen to find out what other people discovered, and if in a few years' time when I've done my undergraduate degree, that if they still haven't found anything, then definitely I'd be really keen to take it on.
Did anyone inspire you, and how did it feel when you were doing this project?
Actually, my main source of inspiration was my mentor for the project. I was really nervous before I went because I didn't know any of the people that I'd been working in the lab with. But she was really keen. Every time I messed up a procedure, she'd be there to encourage me. And whenever I got the results I wasn't expecting, she made sure that I continued to stay determined, that I continued to be persistent and carry on. Well, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. So, if everyone wants to stay in here, there's a talk next. There's also a workshop.
Yeah. So, does anyone know where the register for workshops?
Society and also a fellow of the Academy of the Medical Sciences, and her work has enabled children born with diabetes to move from insulin injections to tablet therapy, which is really incredible. She was a winner of the L'Oreal UNESCO Award for Women in Science in 2012 and appointed a DVE for her services to medical science and the public understanding of science. So I'm happy to welcome Professor Dame Frances Ashcroft.
Thank you very much. Thank you. So it's a huge pleasure to be here today, and I must say I've been incredibly impressed with the talks that I've heard so far. So a great privilege to be invited, and I'd like to in particular thank Christina Aston for organising my trip so brilliantly, and also Katie for looking after me and for the introduction today. So I've been asked to tell you a little bit about how a passion for natural history, and in particular wild orchids, has led me to be a scientist researching diabetes, and in turn how that's led us to help patients with a very rare form of diabetes to a new therapy. In other words, how did I get from this sort of little seven-year-old kid to a professor at Oxford University, the other place? So I had a really unprepossessing start. So there was only one of my people in my family who'd ever been to university, and that was my grandfather, who you see here, whom in fact I never met because he died before I was born, alas. And he went to Oxford, and then he went off to teach in Heliopolis, and here he is with his class of students all with their feathers on. So, but he was in the English side, so he didn't inspire me at all, and especially since he was dead. But on the other side, on my mother's side, there were in the past many people who were herbalists, and I even have one of their recipe books today. But unfortunately, over the ages, women who have been herbalists have also been branded as witches. So one of my ancestors was drowned here at the stake in St. Andrews. And sometimes I think how fortunate we are, women, to be born today so that we can be celebrated as scientists and not drowned or burnt to death as witches. So I grew up in a tiny Dorset village, really in the middle of nowhere, and I never expected to go to university, let alone be a scientist. I never had any idea what a scientist actually did. And I went to the local village school, so here's me, and this is the size of the school. It was really tiny, and we were all taught by my mother. So the early science I got was taught by my mum, and It was a very beautiful countryside, so I spent most of my time running around it, and I developed this interest in natural history, and in particular, I've never forgotten the day when I fell through a hedge into a green lane, into a field of wild orchids, common spotted orchids, and here you see them, masses and masses of them, and I thought they were incredibly beautiful. I just started at secondary school, I picked a bunch of them, I was collared at the bus stop by this other girl who said to me, "Those are British wild orchids and they're very rare and you should not have picked them." So we became very good friends and spent most of our time as a joint school when we had any spare time searching for British wild orchids. And we were really lucky because in Dorset there's many different varieties, some of which are very, very rare. And one of these is the early spider orchid, which goes on the clifftops in Dorset. And this is a recent photograph that I took, I have to say, on my, you know, my mobile phone. In those days, we didn't have cameras even, and we had to draw them. And this is my first publication, because we didn't have this wonderful journal that you lot have. So I had to write it all by hand, and this is me and Mandy. And of course, being in Dorset, it's such a beautiful area. There were rock pools to go and look at wild animals in. There were the wonderful geology of the Jurassic coast. So, you know, zoology, botany, they became the things I was most interested in. And I decided that I would apply madly for Cambridge University because two of my friends were doing it and I thought it would be nice to go with them. Unfortunately, in the event, I got a place and neither of them did. So I came here to Cambridge, to Girton College. There was only three women's colleges in those days. Very good sex ratio, I might say, 10 to 1. I mean, 10 men for every girl. We had our choice. So I read natural sciences, and for those of you who are thinking of going to university to read a science subject, I strongly recommend this, even though I'm at Oxford, because what it allows you to do is you don't have to make the selection to begin with. You can pick and choose as you go along, a kind of scientific smorgasbord. So I ended up doing zoology, even though I finally became a physiologist. And then during the summer holidays, I have to tell you about this because it was so much fun, I went on a student expedition and we went overland from Cambridge to Kashmir through Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan, all these places, including Kashmir, which are war zones now. I went to, maybe there's a lesson in that, there shouldn't be too much travelling. And then we, this was what we studied, the rare Kashmir red deer, and this is the sort of place we did our study for, so it was really, really wonderful. And then I came back and I did a PhD in zoology, researching the electrical activity of stick insect muscle fibres under the auspices of John Cahern, and it was a total disaster. You know, I was quite good at just learning things, but making experiments work, there's a real skill to that, and I was not good at it. And I think one of the things that I have learned, and I pass on to you, is that science is the art of failure. You have to be resilient, because it's sure, you know, it's absolutely certain that most of your experiments are not going to work, and you have to be able to cope with that. And I never knew this, but it was subsequently told me that my PhD supervisor thought that he wasn't sure that I would ever get my PhD. But happily, you know, I somehow or other managed to do so. And I went off to do a postdoc with this chap, Peter Stanfield in Leicester University. And this was equally a disaster because he expected me to know everything and I knew nothing. And in particular, I had to build all the electronics for my setup, which I found excruciatingly difficult. I have never forgotten one of the things that Peter said to me, because and what he said was, I would never make a scientist. He was cross with me because he came in and he discovered that I had this one of the knobs on the oscilloscope not in the calibrated position, and I hadn't noticed it. So all my voltages, instead of being 100 millivolts, were something like 70 millivolts. So I was really, really upset, as you can imagine. I found this quite devastating, but in fact, it was a valuable lesson, and I have learned a great deal from that over the years, because it stopped me on several occasions from making really bad mistakes. So one of the things, another lesson I learned is that you should always listen to what people tell you, take note of it and act upon it. And don't look at it as something which is negative. Try to always take the positive out of it. Anyway, somehow or other, working together, we got a number of papers, and the consequence of that was that I was offered a job in Oxford, my own lab to set up. And so when I got there, this was only for the short term, so I spent the next few years trying to get a permanent job, you know, what everybody wants, a university lecturer. I applied for 6 of them in my department, and I failed to get all of them. And in fact, this doesn't happen now, but I distinctly remember on this one occasion sitting next to, I mean, part of the, you won't believe this, but part of the interview was to have dinner at one of the Oxford colleges, just to make sure that you could use your knife and fork correctly. Well, since I came from, you know, rural Dorset, maybe I couldn't. But what happened was, I sat down after dinner and this old bloke sat down next to me and he said, patting my knee, "My dear, I'm sure you're very good at what you do, but I just wouldn't feel comfortable with women in the college, so I won't be voting for you." And sure enough, I didn't get the job. But, you know, it's changed, I can tell you. But it's, again, you know, you just ignore it and just bulldoze your way forward and you'll get there in the end, because eventually I did get a lecture. And the thing I realised subsequently was that not having a lectureship was fantastically useful. And so this was a very advantageous experience to have not got those lectureships, because it allowed me to focus on the research and get all my lab set up before I had to take on the teaching as well. So the important thing is to be positive in whatever it is you're doing and never, ever, ever give up. And the things that, you know, you think of as a problem at the time can actually often turn out to be beneficial. So anyway, when I was in Oxford, I decided that setting up my own lab, I would switch field. I didn't want to be, you know, tarred with the brush of the people I'd be working with, and I decided to work on diabetes. And I did it deliberately because the science for me was really exciting. There were people in Oxford who were working in the same area whom I could collaborate with. And because it was a disease, I thought it might be easy to get money for it. This is something you always have to think about today. So this painting is by John Nash. We've heard a bit about the First World War today, and the 100th anniversary. And many people died in that, 4.5 million each year, which is a huge number of people, and it's considered, you know, one of the greatest losses of human life in the 20th century. But what I think people don't recognise so widely is that, in fact, just about the same number of people die each year today, worldwide, of diabetes. Last year, it was over 5 million people. Well, in 2013, over 5 million people. So every 6 seconds, somebody dies of diabetes. And children are becoming increasingly affected by type 2 diabetes. And the reason is because we're all becoming more obese, and diabetes, type 2 diabetes, is exacerbated by age and obesity, as I would say. So if you look around you in this room, because of the number of people sitting here, it is inevitable that some of us are going to have type 2 diabetes eventually. So I decided that I wanted to work on this disease because it was becoming so common. It is, as you know, defined by an increase in your blood glucose concentration, and this is because you lack sufficient insulin. And as I'm sure you all know, insulin is a key player in glucose homeostasis. And every time you have something to eat, your blood sugar will rise, and this stimulates the release of insulin, the hormone, from the beta cells of the pancreatic islets. And what insulin then does is to stimulate the uptake of glucose into muscle, liver, and fat, and so restore the blood sugar level to its resting concentration. And diabetes occurs if you have a deficiency of insulin, not enough for the body's requirements. And this can happen either because of impaired insulin action in the tissues, something which is known as insulin resistance, and invariably one of the things which causes this is becoming too fat. But that is not the only reason why you might get diabetes. The other reason is that your beta cells simply don't release enough insulin, even though you're very slim. And there are many people who are very slim who have diabetes. And as I'm sure you know, there's more than one type of diabetes. But they all result from lack of insulin. So type 1 diabetes, which some of you may have actually, is childhood in onset, affects around 5-10% of people with diabetes. And the beta cells are destroyed by an autoimmune attack, and so there's nothing much that can be done other than either transplant or insulin injection. The most common form of the disease is type 2 diabetes, which affects around 90% of people with the disease. It's extremely common, as we've already heard, 500 million of us in the world. And this is caused by mutations in multiple genes which increase your risk of getting the disease. And then it's exacerbated by age, which you can do nothing about, and obesity, which hopefully we can do something about. And the problem here is that your pancreatic beta cells are present, and they even have a bit of insulin inside them, but they just don't release it in response to a rise in blood sugar. They are glucose blind. And the form of diabetes I want to talk about today is a monogenic form of diabetes, which is caused by a mutation in a single gene. And these are normally really quite rare. And in the case I'm going to talk about, the pancreatic beta cells are present, but again, they don't respond to glucose. So you might say, well, we have insulin. We can treat people with insulin. We can keep them alive. They'll live out their normal lifespan. So why do we worry? Of course, insulin was discovered in 1922 by Banting, Best, Collip, and McLeod. And here is the dog Marjorie, the first dog who they were able to keep alive on insulin injections after they'd removed her pancreas. But as Banting said in his Nobel lecture, insulin is not a cure for diabetes, it's a treatment. It keeps people alive. But over time, people with diabetes can develop secondary complications because of the elevated blood glucose. And these can be an increased risk of heart disease, of blindness, you lose the sensation in the lower limbs due to nerve damage or poor circulation, and the consequence of that is that diabetes is one of the most common causes of non-traumatic amputation. And 30% of the patients on the kidney dialysis ward are there due to diabetes. Now, as those of you with diabetes will know, the risk of complications is reduced by good control of blood sugar. But it's not easy. It's actually quite difficult to control your blood sugar as well as a pancreatic beta cell can do it on a second-by-second basis. So what we really need to understand is how the pancreatic beta cell works and what goes wrong in diabetes. And so, I've said this slide before, back in, long before you were born, I'm afraid, I set out to try to understand how a rise in your blood sugar level gives rise to the release of insulin from the pancreatic beta cell. And what we knew at the time was that glucose was taken up by the beta cell, it was broken down. This gave rise to electrical activity, which was due to the opening of these tiny pores called calcium ion channels in the plasma membrane. Calcium ions flowed into the cell, and it was that triggered insulin release. I don't know why something's playing music here. My apologies. Anyway, so for those of you who don't know what an ion channel is, there are tiny protein pores that sit in the membrane that surround every one of our cells and that of every organism on Earth. And basically, they open and close. And when they're open, ions can flow through them, and when they're shut, iron movement is prevented. And the channel I want to talk about is opened and closed by the binding of the compound ATP to the inside of the membrane. And when ATP binds, this channel closes. And it's normally conducting potassium ions. Because potassium ions carry a charge, they will, when they move, they will carry a current, and you can measure these currents using a technique known as the patch pump technique, and this is what the currents sort of look like, and they're really, really tiny. So the amplitude is about 1 million millionth of the current that's needed to power an electric kettle. As you can see, the magnitude's around a picoamp or so. So this is what I used to dream about for many years, little green blips on the oscilloscope screen. And what I set out, what I thought was that there must be an ion channel which was closed by glucose. So I set out to look for it, and this is the way I did it. I brought this electro-glass pipette filled with a conducting salt solution down onto the surface of the cell, isolated just one of these little ion channels in the patch of membrane under the electrode, and then recorded the tiny currents that flowed through the channels when they open. And this is what I saw. And I found, I made this recording at about 8 o'clock one night after a long day, and I was incredibly, incredibly excited. Because you can see why. Here is this ion channel, which is opening and closing here in the absence of glucose. When I added glucose, the channel openings went away, and when I removed the glucose, they came back again. And so this was probably what was going to be the channel which was coupling glucose to the electrical activity of the cell. Now, we knew that glucose had to be metabolized, broken down in order to do this. So I added glucose again, but this time in the presence of a metabolic blocker. And sure enough, if glucose was present but metabolism was inhibited, then channel activity was present. So within a year, this is what we've discovered. We knew that when glucose is not present outside the cell, metabolism is low, and the level, and as you know, glucose is broken down to produce ATP, the energy currency of the cell. But actually, ATP has another role. ATP is acting here as a kind of second messenger, because what it does is it binds to the channel and shuts it. And so here, when metabolism is low, ATP levels are low, the channels are open, and the consequence of that is no electrical activity and no insulin release. Whereas when your blood sugar level goes up, glucose is broken down to produce ATP, which shuts the channel. This causes the membrane to depolarize and stimulates electrical activity, calcium influx, and insulin release. So this may be a bit complicated for some of you, not, I think, for all of you, but the important thing to remember is when the channels are open, no insulin is released, and when the channels are shut, insulin is released. So, it doesn't take a genius to realize that if you had a mutation that prevented the channel closing when ATP levels went up, then the membrane would remain negative, there'd be no electrical activity, no calcium entry, and no insulin release. And in other words, the patient would have diabetes. So, the thing was, I thought this at 8 o'clock that night many years ago, and I thought I discovered diabetes, and that, this was really the cause of diabetes, this was really exciting. Of course, the next morning, I rang everybody and nobody was at home. But the next morning they all came piling into my lab to find out what I'd discovered. And I said, I think it was probably a mistake. I think, it can't possibly have been right. And one of the professors in the department said something very important. He said, Fran, it's very simple. Just repeat the experiment. Because if it's right, we'll be able to repeat it. And I'm happy to say that not only could I repeat it, but everybody else in the world could repeat it too, and it's now known that this is exactly what happens. This is how glucose stimulates insulin secretion. So the next question was, were there mutations in this channel which gave rise to diabetes? So that took a long time. It took 20 years of perseverance. And the reason was that, first of all, we had this, we had this electrophysiological observation. How did we get the DNA to test people, to test whether patients had mutations? What was the DNA that coded for their channel? Well, in order to do that, we had to find it. We couldn't simply go to a database like you can do now and look it up. So it took 10 years to get hold of the DNA, and part of the reason was because the channel is made of two different proteins, and you need both of them to make a channel. One is not enough. So it was not an easy problem. Anyway, finally we got there, so we cloned one subunit, and somebody else the other one. We put them together and made a channel. So then we went off to screen the patient's DNA. What do you think we found? Well, we didn't find any mutations, much to my disappointment, although we did find a common genetic variant that's associated with a small increase in the risk of the disease. So I was very upset and very puzzled, and then my clever postdoc said, well, Fran, we're looking at the wrong people. You know, we should be looking at people who are born with diabetes, because if they have a genetic defect, why would we have to wait until they're 50 years old to develop diabetes? Why would they not have it at birth? So I trotted back to my clinical colleagues and said, please can we have some DNA from people who are born with diabetes? And they said, no, they don't exist. We've never heard of them. Well, you know, I should have listened to the motto of the Royal Society, nullius in verba, take nobody's word for it. Because, of course, they do exist. They're just very rare. So never believe what people tell you. Check it out for yourself. So it took another 10 years before they were found. And it wasn't found by me, but by a friend of mine, Andrew Hattersley, and his team down in Exeter University. And this is another red letter day for me, because I've never forgotten the day Andrew rang me up and he said, Brad, I think you should sit down. I've got something to tell you. And he told me that he found the first mutation in the subunit of the ion channel that we work on that I had cloned. And so he would like us to test it to see if the mutation he found was functional and was causing the diabetes in his patient. And that turned out to be the case. And we now know that mutations that make the channel stay open, activating mutations, are a cause of diabetes at birth. So these patients are born with diabetes, or they develop it within the first 6 months of life. They have very high blood glucose levels. They also have a low birth weight, because insulin is a growth factor, and if you don't have it, then the babies are born small. And most of these mutations occur spontaneously, so they're not found in either of the parents. So it's really quite difficult to know whether you're going to have a baby with this problem. And what they do is they prevent ATP from closing the channel. And the other thing that turned out to be quite fascinating is that some of these patients don't just have diabetes, they also have neurological complications. They have developmental delay, they have weakened floppy muscles, they have attention deficit disorder. And 3% of them have epilepsy. So we had the great privilege of having identified a new syndrome, and we were able to name it. So we called it developmental delay, epilepsy, and neonatal diabetes, DEN syndrome. And I will show you in a minute how we analysed these mutations, but I just want to show you this, which is another thing which I have wanted to do, was to get the structure of the channel. Unfortunately, I failed at this, but a friend of mine has just recently done it using the revolutionary new technique of cryo-electron microscopy, which, as some of you will know, just won the Nobel Prize from a colleague just down the road here in Cambridge. It's very exciting. So you can see here, this is a pore-forming subunit in the middle. The ions go through this hole in the center, and these are the regulatory subunits stuck out on the side. And this is it. It's not breathing, it's opening and closing. And if we just take this subunit in the middle here, and we look at it here, I don't think this video is going to work. Let's see. Oh, yeah. No, it's not going to. But what you see is the pore-forming subunit looked at from the side. Here's the membrane. And here is the cytosolic domain. And here is the outside. The purple things are the potassium ions moving through. Here in red, you see amino acids which are mutated in neonatal diabetes. And they all sit here, which is where ATP binds, or in bits of the channel that move when the channel opens and closes. So to study them, we went back to this technique I showed you earlier, where we isolate a small patch of membrane with an ion channel in the middle of it, but in this case, instead of leaving it attached to the cell, we remove the electrode from the surface of the cell, and this rips out the small patch of membrane, and it has its intracellular surface facing the bath solution, so we can add ATP to the inside to see if it's blocked or not. And over here you see what happens with the wild-type channel, and over here what happens with the mutant channel. So ATP blocks this channel, doesn't really touch this one. And we found that the disease severity correlates with the ability of ATP to block the channel. So this is the current that remains in the presence of 3 millimolar magnesium ATP here on the wild-type channel, from a non-diabetic, and you'll see it's almost completely blocked. But over here are the mutations which give rise to just diabetes, here to diabetes with developmental delay, and here to diabetes, developmental delay, and epilepsy. So there's a kind of spectrum of disease. The more you reduce your ATP sensitivity, the worse the clinical phenotype. And so at one end, we have the patients who have epilepsy and diabetes. Here we have the patients who just have diabetes. And at this far end, we have probably you and me, because these are people who have a genetic variant, not a mutation, but a variant, that gives you a small increase in your risk of getting type 2 diabetes, about a 1% increase, very tiny, but still measurable. So then the question is, what does this mean for therapy? Well, as I told you before, people who have type 1 diabetes, who usually get it early, are always treated with insulin injections because it is because they haven't got any beta cells left. So it was assumed in the past that this form of neonatal diabetes was simply a form of type 1 diabetes that manifested unusually early, i.e. they got it at birth rather than at age 2, for example. So they're all treated with insulin. Not everybody enjoys sticking a needle in them, as you can see from this drawing by a 9-year-old boy. And you can imagine that it's actually very difficult for parents who have to treat a tiny, few-week-old baby by injecting the baby with insulin. And as these young boys tell you here, life with diabetes is no easy feat because you're always having to calculate how much insulin you need to inject. And I know this very well because my young nephew has type 1 diabetes and has to inject himself with insulin. Get you an insulin pump. So with these patients, however, it wasn't necessarily the case that their beta cells had all been killed off. We knew that what happened was the mutation made their channels open. So essentially, they were simply switched off. So if we could have a drug that blocked this channel, we should be able to stimulate insulin secretion in the patient. And we actually had such a drug, which was found by this friend of mine. Well, let's put it like this, he wasn't a friend to begin with, because I had exactly the same data as him, and I was ready to publish it when I got his damn paper to review. So I wasn't incredibly happy about it. And nevertheless, I accepted his paper, and then I met him a few months later in a swimming pool in Alicante at a conference, you know, as one does. And we decided that collaboration was better than competition, and we should work together. So we've been doing that now for over 30 years. So I recommend collaboration. But choose your collaborators wisely because you're going to be spending a lot of time with them. And this shows, so then we thought, well, maybe we could take the sulfonylurea drug and give it to our patients. It should block the channel. And so this is exactly what was done. And you can see here a patient, and this is their blood sugar level, which has been continuously monitored. And here is where they have their insulin injections. Well, actually, I'm not sure, but anyway. This is, here they get vancomycin, and you can see that their blood sugar level comes down within just a couple of days, and the oscillations in blood glucose are so much better. And now 90% of patients with this disease have transferred to drug therapy, and both their clinical condition and quality of life improve. And actually, You may ask about the neurological complications, the hypotonia and muscle weakness, and I just thought I'd show you this little animation here. So this is, I forgot to upload them again. I don't think the animations are going to work. Never mind. Oh, maybe they are. Let me see. Am I? Yes, they are. No, they're not. Solid. What you would normally see is this darling little boy is just sort of trying to pull himself along on his tummy because he hasn't got the strength to push himself up on his arms and knees. But a month after taking the drug, he can stand up and walk. And when I saw that video, that made us all burst into tears. So this is some of the things the kids say, that now they can, their parents allow them to do all of these things which they wouldn't allow them to do before because they were nervous about them having a hypoglycemic attack. They can play football, they can go and stay with their friends. Even they can wear, the young girl who said to me, thanks to you I can wear a dress. And I said, well, what do you mean? And she said, well, I've always had to have, trousers or a skirt, a waistband on which to hang my insulin pump. And now I don't need it, so I can wear a skinny dress. And it has been life-transforming for them, but it's also been life-transforming for me. I mean, I should say, I'm talking too much, I better cut. You can ask me later. But it's been life-transforming for me. This is the sort of thing that the patients have written to me. And it is quite extraordinary when you actually are able to meet these cute little children. And they come running up to you and throw their arms around you. And the reason I've been lucky enough to meet them is because we held this neonatal diabetes day for the patients at the Royal Society, so that they could meet one another. Because, if you have a very rare disease, it's actually very valuable to meet parents who also have children with the same rare disease, so you know what to do when they, for example, are being constantly sick and they can't take a pill instead of their insulin. So this was held in the UK, and pretty soon the people in the US got into the act too, and here you can see that I'm not very good with babies, actually. Yeah. So this has been a kind of 20-year odyssey, and 1,000 patients now have switched to tablet therapy. And although it seems like a long time, we were really lucky to be so fast. And the reason it worked was because we knew what the gene did in the beta cell. That was our contribution. We actually had a drug that had been used for 50 years to treat patients with type 2 diabetes that we could use in babies. We didn't require any clinical trials, which takes ages and costs a lot of money. And although it's only a few patients, I can tell you it's been a big benefit to them and also transformed my life. But of course it took many, many people. These are just some of the people in my team. It took millions of pounds. It took lots of collaborators throughout the world. It took my great friends, who I've already shown you, all the families and their patients and their clinicians. And it's been fantastic. So what have I learned along the way? Well, I think these are the things I recommend to you. Never, ever, ever give up. This is, of course, what Churchill said, and you should listen to him. You might not listen to me, but just keep going. Learn how to cope with failure, because whatever you do, it will happen all the time. But if you lack self-confidence, as I did, just pretend. I mean, just get up there and act straight. Although I have to say, I was really, really impressed by how confident all the speakers that we saw today were. I don't know if that was true or whether they were acting, but it looked as if they were. Never be afraid to ask for help. And that's something I never did to begin with, and everybody is always eager to help. Collaboration is so much better than competition. Whatever you're going to do, it helps if you can learn to write well and to speak well. And it's very important to be able to explain to anybody from 8 to 80 what you do. And that's true even if you're not doing science. And it was certainly true for me, and I decided that I would write a couple of science books along the way, which has been really good fun. And remember, when you're doing these jobs that you do, whatever it might be, but particularly in science where you're so excited about it and you spend all your time in a lab, it's not a good idea. You should take some time off. And this is one of the things I do to take time off. And this is, we're still hunting with my best friend from school, would be that. Still hunting from orchids. for orchids. So what I've learned along the way is this. Just get out there and do it. Find your passion, stick with it, and carry on. Thank you very much.
If there are any questions, then I'm sure that's a good one to ask. So, does anyone have any questions?
Okay, so I have a couple of questions. My first question is, how did you feel during learning about all of these different things about diabetes? Like, how was it for you?
What do you mean? How did I feel about meeting the patients?
Yeah.
It was incredibly fantastic. I decided that I didn't want to be a doctor. I wanted to be the person who, let me put it crudely, it's not very fair, but I wanted to be the car designer rather than car mechanic. And I wanted to be the person who discovered things. I think this is what science is all about. You know, we are the people who make discoveries, and I do this for curiosity, because I want to know how it works. And if it helps patients, that is a bonus, and it's a wonderful bonus. But it isn't the main reason that I started out to do it.
And my second question is, if somebody, like your parent, has got like a type 2 diabetes, have you got a higher risk of getting it?
Not really. I mean, you might. There are two reasons why you might have a slightly higher risk. You might carry some. I mean, type 2 diabetes, there is a small contribution that is genetic. So therefore, that would suggest that there is a possibility that if you had some of those genes, you might have a slightly higher risk. But type 2 diabetes today is often associated with being overweight, and so the most important thing is to stay slim and take regular exercise, and you massively reduce your risk of type 2 diabetes. I have a trainer, and she has a mother and an aunt and all the other women in her family who have type 2 diabetes. But she does regular exercise, and she certainly takes great care of what she eats, and she is completely fine. So, and she's in. I think that told me I should stop answering that question. Next one. You've got your hand up, stick shag.
So my question is, you said, you talked about it like one time, like two things. So like, you know, well, like, what's wrong with the other one? Is there anything more like the worst things of the result?
The type of diabetes, whether, so the question was, how about the other type of diabetes? Oh, you mean insulin resistance? It's very rare to have a mutation in the insulin receptor. It does happen. But that is not associated, interestingly, with diabetes. It produces a disease called leprechaunism, and it's very rare. The problem is that the problem with insulin resistance is it simply means that you need more diabetes, so you're more insulin, so your beta cells have to work harder. So if they're already not perfect to begin with, then you will get diabetes. But there are some people who are immensely obese and they never get diabetes. We'd really quite like to understand why they don't, but they obviously have gene variants and so on. They have very healthy beta cells, quite obviously. Yes, shout. I mean, unless somebody's got the microphone.
How did you prevent the drug that you discovered from affecting normal healthy cells, so the potassium ions?
That is a very good question, because of course the CERN is found in lots of tissues. It turns out to be very very useful, because although the channel is found in other tissues, it's normally closed. It only opens in response to anoxia, you know, or ischemia or something. So normally it's shut, apart from the pancreatic beta cells. So the side effects of this drug are minimal. The main side effect is taking too much of it, which stimulates too much insulin secretion and gives you a hypoglycemic attack.
And what are you working on now?
Oh, yes. So this story is sort of finished, and somebody scooped us on the structure. So what we're trying to look at now is I'm very interested in what happens to your pancreatic beta cells when you have high blood sugar levels, because it's clear from these patients and from lots of other data that actually high blood glucose damages your cells. It stops them stimulating, it stops them releasing insulin, and it generates this kind of vicious cycle. So your blood sugar level goes up a little, so insulin secretion is reduced, so therefore your blood sugar level goes up a bit more, and it goes round and round until you've got full-blown diabetes. And it's so interesting, there's a lot of work coming out at the moment which suggests that type 2 diabetes, which is what we're working on, is potentially reversible, at least for some time. So if you take people who have newly diagnosed type 2 diabetes and you put them on a very low calorie diet or intensive insulin therapy, their beta cells start to get better, and after a while they can, you know, they can they don't need insulin for a while. How long that will last, we don't know, because this is all new, but and this is not our work, but it's a really interesting thing to try to understand what's going on. And I think it's that high blood sugar damages these cells.
What was it that inspired you to start working on diabetes? Was it just that other people were doing it, or?
Oh, you know, I'm not entirely sure. I decided that I didn't want to work anymore on stick insect muscle fibres, because neither my mother nor the taxi driver ever understood the relevance of it. And I thought that I would choose something different. But one of the reasons was that at that time, this new technique called the patch clamp that I described to you, that enables you to look at the activity of single ion channels, had just been invented. And I think I was the third person in the UK to actually start it. So for somebody who wasn't very confident, it was a mad idea, but I did. And what it meant was that all of the cells in the human body were open to study, because it had been never possible to look at tiny mammalian cells before. Because whenever you tried to put a glass electrode into them, a sharp electrode that penetrated the membrane, you damaged them so much that they died. So I had my pick, and I thought, well, you know, I know that beta cells have interesting electrical activity, so, and they're small and round, so I'll go for those. And there were, but there was another reason, which is rather daft, but I'll tell you anyway. And that was, it turned out that there was a guy in Oxford who was working on pancreatic beta cells, who had the name of Ashcroft, and I thought how cool it would be to publish a paper, Ashcroft and Ashcroft. And what I hadn't envisaged was that it was really bad in other ways, because everybody assumed we were married, so that really spoilt my chances.
Thank you. Can I ask the question that you left hanging?
Yes.
In your talk about the benefits of your research and how they benefited you personally.
Oh, that one. What I was going to tell you is a story about that the patients feel normal, and that is quite extraordinary. They're not actually cured, but they feel that they are, because taking a pill seems to be different from injecting yourself. And I've never forgotten this guy who I met at one of the conferences, and he's a very tall, very energetic 35-year-old or something, and I think he works for McDonald's, actually. And he said to me, "Fran, I knew I was going to see you today, so I took my blood sugar level." And it was normal, of course. He said, "To be honest, I haven't bothered to do it for the last 6 months, because it's always normal." And I thought, gosh, he really does feel normal. Yeah, no, it's a huge privilege. You know, as a scientist, you usually, I mean, you do the experiments for curiosity. and you never imagine it's going to change people's lives. And when it does, it's life transforming for you too.
So between 84 and 2004, you were struggling with this problem. It was a journey.
Yeah.
How did you keep your optimism? And did funding ever look like it might dry up?
Well, the thing was, we weren't idle. We did lots and lots of other experiments, and we were trying to understand how the channel worked. So we, we tried to discover how ATP actually inhibited it, which subunit it bound to, how the two subunits talked to one another, this sort of thing. The funding was actually fine. For some reason, they were keen to fund that. They're less keen to fund type 2 diabetes stuff, but it was all right. So there were plenty of things to be optimistic about and new ideas to follow and so on. So, but I think the thing is, sometimes you have ideas or thoughts which are too early to be able to address because the technology is not available. So you start out, you fail. Then, something else comes along and you try again. And that's what we did. I mean, with the technique I told you about, the patch clamp, that was invented by two German scientists, Neo and Sutton, who won the Nobel Prize in 1963. Maybe it was later. They knew exactly what they wanted, and they tried to build this piece of electronics, but the field effect transistors were not of high enough quality for them to do so. So every time a new one came out from the manufacturers, they would get it, rebuild their equipment, try to make it work. And when it came to getting the feedback resistor, they, in order to measure a very tiny current, they needed a very, very high resistant resistor of the order of gigaohms, and it had to be very stable. And so, in the end, what they did was they bought the whole of the output of the gigaohm resistors from one company, and they went through and they tested every single one for its quality, thousands of them, and they found a few that were, good enough, and then they gave all the rest back to the company, and they used those ones. And then they did something which I think was fantastic, because building your own bit of electronics is, well, not everybody can do it, and it's always very fiddly. So they set up a company and they built these machines, and within a few years, the number of people using them had gone from, about 30 or so to many thousands, and it's now a kind of workhorse.
Was there anything that held you back from the experience?
Held me back from doing what I did. Lack of confidence, I think. Being a woman, sorry to say. All the usual things, If you don't get a grant, you feel miserable. You put it to one side and think, I need to do it, but maybe I better clean the kitchen first. That sort of procrastination. That the usual stuff. So, the important thing is, as I said, you just have to turn that little motor in the middle of your back like a clockwork soldier and just go off and do it. And it can be difficult sometimes. Because life is shit, all sorts of things get in the way. I probably didn't say that. But this is what one of my very dear friends said. But it's what's happening. You discover, your mum dies, your father is sick, your nephew gets type 1 diabetes. There are all these other things in life that you have to cope with. And so for me, doing science has been the kind of escape. It is the Zen experience. I can go to the lab, and if everything's failing, my partner's left me, all that sort of crap, then you focus on the science, because it is this thing which can take you out of yourself, and so you cease to worry about the cares of the world, which we all have. Maybe you don't get, but you'll certainly try to do.
How do you manage the conflict
being
women in a field that is generally dominated by
women? By ignoring being female. I was just so interested in the science. And actually, I had lots and lots of male supporters. I think we shouldn't ignore the fact that some of the best supporters of women in science are men. And I had marvellous mentors who looked up to me and, you know, promoted me, put me up for the Royal Society, this sort of thing. The women aren't always supporters of other women, I have discovered. So it's important we all look after each other. And I don't, you know, I think as a scientist, it's what's in here that counts. It doesn't matter, you know, what your gender is, what your colour of your skin is, what, where you come from, how much money you've got. What matters is whether you can think in the way that you need for science and the determination and perseverance to follow it through. And I should say that I think that's more important than being clever. Perseverance.
Thank you for everyone here, but I'm speaking more really good.